Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is a final evidence session on our inquiry into the National Performance Framework, Ambitions into Action. I welcome to the meeting the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, John Swinney, MSP. Mr Swinney is accompanied by Scottish Government officials, Barry Stalker, Head of National Performance Framework Unit, and Caroline Dodds, Team Leader, National Performance Framework Unit. I welcome you all to the meeting and invite Mr Swinney to make a short opening statement.
Good morning, Convener. I welcome the opportunity to appear before the committee today on the inquiry that the committee is undertaking into the National Performance Framework. Though the National Performance Framework is highly regarded domestically and internationally, we must grapple with the complex question of how to translate the ambition it sets out into concrete actions for improvement. There will not be one straightforward answer to that question, but by drawing on the experience of those who use the national outcomes to shape policy making and service delivery across local government, the public sector, business organisations and the voluntary sector, I'm confident that effective solutions can be found. Drawing on these experiences and voices exemplifies something of what the National Performance Framework is all about encouraging partnership, collaboration and recognising the part that we all play in improving the well-being of people in Scotland. Meeting the challenges of COVID recovery, achieving net zero and reducing child poverty will require more and more of this kind of collaboration, and we must therefore listen carefully to unlock more of the National Performance Framework's potential. I've been grateful to see the responses the committee has already received from the call for evidence and the oral evidence sessions as part of this inquiry. The breadth of response from across Scottish society demonstrates the wide appeal of the National Performance Framework and the potential it has to bring together different sectors across the same outcomes. The responses underscore the strength of commitment there is to the National Performance Framework and the progress that we've made since 2018 in making the framework an approach for all of Scotland, not just for government. We can and must learn from organisations who have effectively shaped their policies, programmes and systems around outcomes and who can demonstrate impact on the national outcomes. They do, however, also present important evidence highlighting issues and areas where we can improve. Issues such as accountability, budgeting for outcomes and integrating the National Performance Framework into the systems and processes of government are all areas where improvements can be made, and I will continue to listen to these important contributions and consider how we will respond. This inquiry is also timely as the upcoming review of the national outcomes presents an opportunity to put ideas into action. The review undertaken in partnership with COSLA will consult widely with communities across Scotland on the national outcomes and will go further by considering how the National Performance Framework can achieve greater impact. Public engagement is due to start from the 23rd of June to be launched at the National Performance Framework Conference and will give communities, charities, businesses and organisations in Scotland various opportunities to influence what our national outcomes are and how we can create the environment for them to be achieved. The findings of this inquiry will be considered as part of that review. As the committee has requested, we will provide Parliament with ample time to consider the findings of the review and any proposed changes to the National Performance Framework that it will lead to. And I'm very happy to address any issues from the committee.
Thank you very much for that opening statement. I think that in the opening statement you kind of hit the nail on the head a wee bit in terms of probably the most significant issue, I think, which has come out of the evidence sessions so far, certainly from what I've been hearing, and that's really about accountability and budgeting for outcomes. So particularly in the round table, but in other sessions as well, a number of witnesses have given evidence, have said that typically, the National Performance Framework is not actively used to shape scrutiny, provide sponsorship, undertake commissioning work or shape the allocation of funding. And indeed, what they've said is that the National Performance Framework could be more closely linked to budget planning. And questions have been asked about that without any real answers forthcoming. So I'm just wondering how you believe we can make the National Performance Framework more responsive to these concerns.
I think this is, a central issue because for the National Performance Framework to be effective, it has to be a statement of what we as a country are trying to achieve, the outcomes that support those aspirations. And inevitably, funding and policy decisions at an operational level will be of enormous significance in whether or not those aspirations are achieved. So I was interested in some observations shared with the committee from North Ayrshire Council, which of course is well known to yourself, Convener. But North Ayrshire Council provided input to the inquiry, and I quote, "The national outcomes influence the development of our council plan, which outlines our priorities agreed with our communities and is North Ayrshire Council's central plan. It forms part of the golden thread linking national outcomes through to each employee's daily activities." Now, in a sense, that captures the sense of importance that we want to attach to the National Performance Framework of establishing a relationship between, in that particular example from North Ayrshire Council, the contribution from an individual employee is connected right through to the national outcomes as part of the National Performance Framework. Similarly, budgeting should be so aligned. And I think that is an issue that we have got to be constantly mindful of in all of the planning and decision-making that we undertake, that we should not be taking decisions or making judgments that are not aligned to the aspirations that are set out in the National Performance Framework. And accordingly, we should be able to link decision-making at an operational level with the achievement of those outcomes.
Yeah, I mean, I think the point you've made is a really important one. I think the phrase golden thread actually ran through a number of submissions was certainly raised in evidence. And what I found, both in the workshop in Dundee and indeed talking to government officials, talking to people giving evidence across the board, was that there's actually really strong support and strong backing for what the National Performance is and what it's trying to achieve. But there's an issue about how patchy it can be in terms of government's response to the way it sets its own outcomes. And this failure to align budgets to outcomes has caused an element of frustration which came out last week. So, for example, organisations who take the NPF very seriously feel that, well, they're following that, but there's no real reward, if you want to put it that way, for aligning themselves very closely with the NPF, and other organisations who are much more loosely associated with the NPF, well, there's no backlash for that. You know, the government doesn't take that into account either. So it's almost as if the government has set these outcomes and then has allowed people more or less to get on with it without any real kind of focus on, well, what can we do to encourage more people from a financial perspective into pursuing these outcomes? And that's why we have, you know, a patchy kind of situation across the country, which I don't think any of us want to see. People want to see, you know, best practice being followed everywhere. So it's just about how we can tighten that up a wee bit. And I think a number of witnesses gave evidence to suggest that in its own documents, sometimes government departments don't even mention the National Performance Framework when they're actually setting out objectives. And that, again, makes some organisations feel that perhaps it's not really something that the government is as focused on as it says it is or it should be. So how will the government address these issues?
I think the first thing I would have to say, and I should have said this in my original answer to your question, Convener, is that I think I would accept that there will be a patchy degree of engagement about these issues. I don't think that's satisfactory, but I think mm-hmm. it's an acknowledgement of reality. So I'm not going to sit here and deny that mm-hmm. That reality. And I think the point that you raise from that about whether there should be a reward or penalty mechanism about that is an interesting one. I think it's one that should be, I think, in a whole variety of different respects, we should consider that as to whether or not there is a, you know, is there a place for the performance of organisations and their utilisation of public money to be a source of, of influencing future decision making. It's not a route the government has gone down. We've gone down more of a route of encouragement, of engagement with organisations to get them to acknowledge the significance of the National Performance Framework and for that to be reflected very much in the government's priorities. But certainly, as I said in my opening statement, the government will look with care at the outcome of this inquiry. And obviously, if the committee comes to conclusions on some of these questions, we will give those issues thorough consideration as we look at what is the role and the content of the National Performance Framework as part of the review that the government will be undertaking.
Yes, I probably put that quite crudely. It's not really about penalising organisations. It's probably about more being more favourably disposed towards those to whom you know, who have engaged and indeed accepted your encouragement.
We might settle on a term like incentivising, convener. That might sum up both of what you and I are going on about this morning. So that might be a better way to think about it.
This is all quite serious because obviously government has outcomes it wants delivered, yep. And there's clearly going to be an element in government if those outcomes are not delivered. So anything that helps achieve those outcomes is surely something that we should try to focus on. There's also an issue about you know, who owns the NPF. You know, it seems to be a kind of whole society approach. There doesn't seem to be a kind of focused driver of the NPF, and again, people feel that perhaps there's not the same kind of prioritisation being given to it as there was, obviously, initially. And I mean, it's been, you know, now some 14, 15 years, and I think that there's a kind of feeling that perhaps it should be re-energised a wee bit with a focus on just exactly who is driving that, so that people are aware of exactly who that would be.
I think the ownership of the NPF is, in my view, very clear. It is owned by the whole of society, but it is driven by the government. And I think that's the best way I could express it, that the delivery of the outcomes within the National Performance Framework will not be all delivered by the government. It needs to be, you know, we need to engage business, for example, as part of that, and you know, so we need to successfully engage the business community on some of these questions. But ultimately, the framework must be owned by the whole of society if we are to have any aspirations to deliver the contents of the National Performance Framework. I think what then emerges is the degree of priority that is given to this by the government in its own agenda, and how we go about encouraging and motivating participation within the framework from a range of different organisations. As to the relevance of the National Performance Framework at this moment in time, in my view, it is more important than ever today. Because if I look at the principal areas of the policy agenda the government wishes to achieve, which are in summary form, an economic recovery from COVID, the eradication of child poverty, and addressing our commitments on net zero. Those three principal aspirations of government policy will not be achieved in neat little compartments within government. They will be, and they will be spread across a range of the national outcomes that are part of the National Performance Framework. So, as a consequence of that, there has to be an encouragement of a collaborative, non-compartmentalised approach to policy making to ensure that we are achieving the policy objectives of the government, and by virtue of achieving the policy objectives of the government, we're doing so in a fashion that is achieving the aspirations of the National Performance Framework.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, that's set my mind ticking over about a number of things, actually, but just to reassure my colleagues without panicking at the prospect of another myriad of questions from me, it won't mean I'll be asking too many more questions. But I would point out, though, that one of the pleasing aspects, I think, of the evidence we took was that both the third and private sectors were actually supportive and indeed enthusiastic about the National Performance Framework. And you touched on issues such as, you know, you talked about, you know, recovery, poverty, having to address climate emergency. Fife, for example, said that those were those three outcomes that they prioritised, and there was a concern about the fact that perhaps there are too many outcomes when perhaps we should really be focusing on these three or four or five, but not really the 11 that we have. And you talked about the importance of the economy, but Scotland's National Strategy for Economic Transformation has only got two references to the National Performance Framework, and there's no alignment there with national outcomes. So if the government is actually trying to ensure that everything is cross-cutting and everything's working to the same agenda, etc., an important document like that should surely have taken cognizance to a greater extent over the National Performance Framework.
I wouldn't share your assessment of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, convener. I'm happy to debate it, and I would obviously, if the committee concludes on some of these issues, our ministers will reflect on that. But the view I take of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation is that it sets out an approach in relation to economic development, which is inextricably linked to those three themes that I talked to the committee, that I raised in my last answer to you, convener, around COVID recovery, around the eradication of child poverty, around the achievement of net zero, all of which are embedded in the National Performance Framework. Now, if we are judging some of these questions by the degree to which we structure a strategy document, for example, to align with the contents of the National Performance Framework, then in a sort of structural way, you may well have a point. But in terms of the thinking that's in the National Strategy, I think the thinking that is in it is non-compartmentalised, it is collaborative, it is about engaging the various sectors of society to contribute towards the common goals, which are reflected fundamentally at the heart of the national performance by the purpose, which is to focus on creating a more successful country with opportunities for all of Scotland to flourish through increased well-being and sustainable and inclusive economic growth.
I mean, I just think it's important that the National Performance Framework and such documents are seen to underpin it, because I think it's not always easy for people reading that to second guess the government. I mean, maybe that's what the government has in mind, but if it's not actually there in black and white, people will wonder whether or not the government is really prioritising the NPF the way it should be. So I think that's more or less what I'm saying about it, not that it's that it diverges in any way. Well, interestingly,
it may be convener that there is an argument for some of the description and the presentation of that argument to be more explicit, which obviously we could certainly consider that.
Incidentally, a number of people said that one of the difficulties with the National Forms Framework in terms of the wider population, who most of whom I believe probably won't even have heard of it, is the remarkably dull name it has. National Performance Framework, it springs to mind National Planning Framework, same acronym NPF. And people suggested, what about calling it the National Wellbeing Framework, although Ambitions for Scotland to me sounded much more, a better title. Whatever the title is there any way in which, if we're going to be reviewed, perhaps that's something to be reviewed, something that people can feel a bit more... It has a bit more vitality, for example. Somebody said last week that the one way to ensure that a document's not read is to put the words framework, and performance in the title. And that wasn't a kind of, flippant comment. That was actually serious about trying to ensure we get kind of buy-in for more people. So that is an issue I would just ask the Deputy First Minister to actually take away when we actually look at it, look at the document as we move forward. because I do think wellbeing is an issue that the Parliament, I think, is much more enthusiastic about and has much more knowledge of, indeed the public have, than simply the old two-dimensional GDP that we used to look at in the past. And if the, and I think the framework does talk about that. Just one last question from me, that is, and just there's a couple of issues which I think some of our witnesses really struggled with, and that's about how we use the National Performance Framework, or whatever we want to call it in future, to help declutter the public sector landscape, because there is a plethora of documents, and it seems that whenever the government wants to do something new, it brings out an additional document, doesn't seem to replace existing documents or strategies. And how we can share best practice. I actually tried to ask one of our witnesses directly about best practice, now they shared it, and they talked about how they shared it internally, when what I was clearly asking was how they shared it with other organisations. You know, so for example, if a local authority has got an excellent way of working and is delivering in terms of, say, the poverty outcome, how that can be shared with other local authorities. One would assume through COSLA, it doesn't seem to be working perhaps the way it should be. It should. So it's about decluttering and best practice. How can we use the NPF to underpin those?
First of all, Convener, on your questions about titles and terminology, you know, I think that's a reasonable point. I'll take that away and reflect on it. If I was been asked today to give my preference between ambitions for Scotland and the National Wellbeing Framework, not unsurprisingly, Convener, I'd be in agreement with yourself on ambitions for Scotland being a bit more uplifting about these things. But I think there's a fair point that's got to be explored in there. In relation to the question of decluttering, I think that you make a fair point, Convener. I think there's as time goes on, there are new policy initiatives come forward. There are moments at which you have to take stock and just simplify some of these exercises. That's what we'll be looking to do as part of the work that is undertaken on the National Performance Framework, so that it becomes ever more meaningful to people and organisations. You know, its purpose is not really to, I think, to reach. You know, we don't need to build public awareness about the National Performance Framework. We need to build public awareness of the effect of the National Performance Framework. That's what matters. What's the difference to people and their experience of public services and their experience of the workings of various organisations? What difference does it make in their lives, as opposed to can they answer 20 questions about the National Performance Framework? So I think there is an opportunity for us to make that more meaningful and more impactful, and we'll certainly reflect on that as part of this process.
Okay, and best practice?
Best practice is, you know, there's every effort is made to ensure that best practice is shared across the community of governance in Scotland, if I can express it that way, you know, within local government. The Improvement Service focuses extensively on this work. We undertake a lot of activities through social investment partnerships, for example, which are looking at new ways in which we can support some of our more vulnerable population and support individuals into activity. And we are sharing some of that best practice across a range of different organisations. So the challenge is about trying to make sure there is an appropriate platform to enable that to be undertaken. I think I would express a frustration that there can often be very good and innovative elements of practice taken forward in some parts of the country, and it takes a long time for it to reach all parts of the country. And that is something that is unsatisfactory. But the National Performance Framework does give us an opportunity to try to enable more organisations and more individuals to see where that best practice lies and how they can learn from it.
Yes, I recall that the Improvement Service was very messianic about best practice when Colin Mayer, the sadly departed,
yes,
Colin,
exactly,
was at the helm. I'm now going to open out the session to colleagues around the table, and the first will be Michelle, to be followed by John.
Good morning, Deputy First Minister. Thank you for attending today. I've just got a couple of questions. The 2015 Community Empowerment Act states that, as you are well aware, that public sector bodies, including local authorities, are required to have regard to the Act in carrying out their functions. And we're also aware that that doesn't apply to city-region deals and the new replacement for EU funds. The Secretary of State for Levelling Up attended this committee and noted and agreed that policy differences could occur, but stated that ideally the engagement would be done through, I'm quoting here, regular dialogue and honesty on our part about where we might diverge. In other words, conceding that there could be divergence. So given that the Scottish Government remains accountable for national outcomes, is there a possibility that the 2015 Act can be reviewed to ensure that all spend, even for these areas that go through public bodies or local authorities, must be aligned to national outcomes?
Michelle Thompson raises an interesting point, because the first term that Ms Thompson raised was the requirements of the 2015 Act on public bodies to have regard to. Now, have regard to could be replaced by must. Mm-hmm. And obviously that's a much higher level of obligation on a public authority. And I think she raises an interesting point about some of the measures that could come forward that might not align with the policy direction that we wish to take forward. The Scottish Government has made absolutely clear to the UK Government our frustration and dissatisfaction with the arrangements that have been put in place around about the Shared Prosperity Fund, for example, because it does not provide, in our view, the satisfactory opportunity for us to ensure that that expenditure, which pre these arrangements would be aligned to the direction of policy travel in Scotland, will be so aligned in the future. Now, I think that makes no sense. I think it's a foolish route for the UK Government to take. But, you know, I've said all this to the UK Government, and the Scottish Government said it to the UK Government, and the UK Government is proceeding with its arrangements. But Michelle Thompson may be raising an issue which the government may consider, which or could consider as providing some greater opportunity to align that expenditure with the prevailing direction of policy travel, because it is about achieving the national outcomes, which, well, we're going through a democratic consultative process about those outcomes, and they may provide a route, a better route to achieve some of those objectives. So yeah, I think it's an interesting issue. But I think the terminology of the 2015 Act, as it stands just now, I don't think would put that obligation on organisations, but it might be able to be made to in the future.
Well, thank you for that, and I'll look forward to hearing more as part of the reflection process. Slightly different question, just picking up on some of the threads that the convener was progressing. I mean, obviously, I can't imagine many members of the public are watching this committee, but I'm sure some other bodies might be watching it. And I suppose I don't think it's generally understood the challenges and complexities that exist in factoring budget, or rather creating that alignment of budgetary spend to outcomes. It's highly complex and it's very difficult. So I would like the Deputy First Minister's flavour of in those areas where he thinks it's practically difficult. And of course, one example that's often cited is our crude measurement thus far, I mean, globally on GDP as compared to well-being indices. So perhaps a follow-on question is that in reflecting on that at some point in the future, might the Scottish Government look to adopt more forcefully some of the newer emerging softer measures around well-being rather than just hard GDP or hard measures? I know it's a complex question in itself, but I just like the DFM's reflections.
There's two elements to that question. The first is in relation to the choices that are made about aligning spending to try to achieve outcomes. And I think I could go through endless examples of where that is difficult, but as a general theme, I think there is a substantive challenge to allocate public expenditure to measures that are designed to be preventative as opposed to measures which are essentially reactive to events. So there are many examples of that. You could take a sum of money and you could have a judgment about whether you deployed that on reactive services like the provision of some degree of healthcare, which is picking up the consequences of illness, or whether you spend the money on encouraging much greater engagement in healthy living and exercise and active travel and all these different things, which actually will be, although longer term investments, much more significant and impactful on improving the general health of the population. Now, the challenge in that example is that if you have an immediate need of emergency or critical intervention, it's difficult not to fund that at the same time as trying to encourage the preventative interventions. Now, we are funding, more and more of our funding decisions are being aligned to preventative interventions, but that doesn't take away the need for emergency and critical interventions as well. I think that debate dilemma is an ever-present debate and dilemma with which we have to wrestle. But I think that probably best sums up the challenge about how do we shift spending to a more supportive direction in relation to the achievement of national outcomes than the current position in which we find ourselves. And I think that's probably the best way to express some of those challenges in that respect. I think then the second aspect of the question, I think, relates very much to the effectiveness of public expenditure and how we are able to measure that effectiveness and what we are as a whole judging to be the central indicators that we are looking at to make a judgment about the health, well-being and vitality of our society. And I think what is certainly, if I look at this debate over the last 15 years that I've been a minister, the debate has changed from a very focused discussion on, frankly, GDP growth in 2007 to a much broader range of considerations today. And I think that reflects part of what the convener said in his questions to me earlier on. And I think the National Performance Framework similarly has to reflect the, it's a broadly based, when I look at the national outcomes, there's no way you could look at those national outcomes and say they are all about GDP, because they're not. There are a broader range of factors. So that has to be reflected. And I think the revision of the wording of the purpose, if I go back to the 2007 wording in that version, I think, if my memory serves me right, and I will no doubt be corrected, was to focus on creating a more successful country with opportunities for all to flourish through increased sustainable economic growth. Mm-hmm. So the wording is broadened in the intervening years. So I think that's a point that we need to continue to consider as we review the framework. And it's important we take people with us, because there will be voices within our society which say, that's too broad. It needs to have a harder, sharper edge, for example, around about GDP. And part of what we are trying to do is, I come at these arguments from the point of view that You know, I think economic opportunity is really absolutely fundamental to the health and well-being of our society, because if people don't have economic opportunity, then, you know, they can't support those they love. So economic opportunity is as relevant to, is relevant right across the spectrum of Scottish society. But I also recognise that just having a job won't necessarily meet everybody's needs and requirements within society. So therefore, there has to be a broader range of considerations.
Yeah, and I think I don't want to take everyone's time. This is a highly complex area to consider, but I think it's a good example you've furnished, the difference between preventative spend and also that preventative spend having a longer sight of funding to lock that in, given that we've got a five-year review point. And I think that's an important point that the DFM has made. So thank you, Convener. Thank you.
John, to be followed by Ross.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, to follow on some of what Kenny Gibson was asking you, the whole thing about, you know, the public is not getting excited about this, as far as I'm aware. None of them, you know, send me abusive emails about the National Performance Framework. They do about other things. So, I mean, is that important? I mean, you seem to be saying that it's the thinking that's important, the kind of, so that we and the local authorities and charities and third sector are all thinking about these values and not necessarily actually using the words and talking about them. Are you satisfied with that, or would it be better if more people throughout society were talking about the National Performance Framework?
We need to have enough people talking about the National Performance Framework, but I think if I was to come to committee and say, I am going to launch a marketing campaign which is going to spend, you see, Liz Smith has reacted to it, as I predicted, she might react to this. I'm going to launch a marketing campaign of X million pounds to raise awareness of the National Performance Framework. I think it would get the reaction from Liz Smith that it just got. It might not be just Liz Smith that gave that reaction. What is critical, however, is that members of the public, in their experience of society, experience the benefit of collaborative policy making focused on the achievement of these outcomes. Because I would venture that people want to live in a country where we tackle poverty by sharing opportunities, wealth and power more equally, where our children grow up safe, loved, safe and respected, so that they can realise their full potential. I think people in society want to have those experiences, but they don't necessarily need to be able to pass the National Performance Framework entrance exam through raised awareness. But for them to experience those outcomes, public organisations, private businesses, third sector organisations have got to be working together to try to achieve those outcomes so that people experience them.
Yeah. I mean, one of the comparisons that's been made has been with Wales and their Future Generations Act. And I believe they have a commissioner who therefore can challenge from outside and challenge the government. Now, we've got commissioners on lots of things already, and presumably we're going to have lots more commissioners going forward. What about the idea of somebody like outside whose specific job was to challenge all of us about, you know, how we tie in with the National Performance Framework?
I think we've got a lot of these organisations already. I dare say that, you know, End Day of the Week Audit Scotland could decide to look at these questions. They have in the past. I don't think that really would add an awful lot of value. There's also Parliament. Parliament's here to challenge on these questions. And this committee, I really welcome this committee's interest and engagement in this question, because I think it gets to the heart of some of the things that occupy a lot of my time as Deputy First Minister, which is about trying to encourage more collaborative approaches to policy making and to service delivery, because, you know, government inevitably is compartmentalised, and we spend a lot of time trying to use the National Performance Framework as a tool to say to the compartments, you've got to collaborate a great deal more with other compartments to achieve outcomes, because we will not transform some of the challenges that affect the constituents that John Mason represents in terms of their experience of poverty and resolving those issues of poverty if we don't work in that more collaborative way.
Yeah, I mean, that's come up quite a lot, the idea that we shouldn't work in silos, we should be collaborative, and I fully agree with that. The counter, or a slightly different suggestion, was made to us by some organisations that it would be helpful to have specific organisations, be that local government or universities or the health service, tied in more to specific outcomes, rather than just saying, well, everybody's responsible for everything. And I think that the kind of thinking was it's harder to hold people to account, like, say, the Greater Glasgow NHS, if they're responsible for everything, whereas if they're responsible for one or two things, it's easier to hold them to account.
I just think it's impossible to break things down in that fashion, because if we take the Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board example, yes, they are exclusively responsible for open heart surgery. Nobody else is responsible for open heart surgery. But their actions are also relevant and significant in the general health and well-being of individuals that in a number of years' time might end up needing open heart surgery because of what they can do in terms of healthy living, nutritional advice, support to communities in terms of projects that will assist in alleviating poverty, which we know to be such a driver of poor health within our society. So some organisations will have exclusive responsibility for certain things, but there will always be a general contribution which these organisations, it's absolutely essential that Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board are able to undertake open heart surgery, but it's equally, in my view, important that they are contributing to the wider health and well-being of our population.
Okay, thank you. And talking of outcomes, Oxfam suggested that there's not really an outcome related to care, and they were suggesting that we might add an outcome or make it a bit more specific. Have you any thoughts on that?
That may well be a reasonable point to consider, and that may well come out of the exercise. By the way, obviously the committee's heard that evidence, but it may also come out of the exercise that the government undertakes in reviewing. Because the national outcomes, there's 11 national outcomes. There will always be scope for people to say, "Ah, but." Mm-hmm. And the question that we have to consider is, to what extent do these "ah buts" merit changing the framework?
Yep.
And I think we should be open to that question, open to challenge on that question.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Okay, thank you very much. Ross, to follow by Daniel.
Thank you. Deputy First Minister, you acknowledged a moment ago there with John Mason that it's not essential that every member of the public has a comprehensive understanding of what the MPF is, but it is important that those who are involved in relevant organisations, public bodies, etc., have some understanding of what we're headed towards. I'm trying to understand, though, the difference between those who are responsible for on-the-ground delivery versus those who are responsible for a level of strategic planning. How important is it that the heart surgeon has an understanding of MPF outcomes versus the senior management team at the hospital or the health board? How important is it that a classroom teacher knows what MPF outcomes specifically they're working towards versus the school senior management team or the council education department? At what level do you expect people to be able to recognise tangible and specific MPF outcomes and their relationship to them?
I think the ethos of the National Performance Framework should be known about by those who are delivering public services and engaged in trying to achieve anything. Well, not just public services, engaged in trying to achieve any of these outcomes. So making sure that, to take one of the examples that Mr. Greer puts to me, a classroom teacher versus senior management, in my opinion, it's both. And I think any classroom teachers that I meet see the wider picture, because they see that it's, if I was to So I don't think classroom teachers generally will think that all they need to attend to is that we are well educated, skilled and able to contribute to society. They will be very mindful of we grow up loved, safe and respected so that we can achieve our potential, that we tackle poverty by sharing opportunities better, and that we protect and fulfil human rights and live free from discrimination, because they'll be living out all of this through the strength of Curriculum for Excellence. So I think there's a... I think what I'm distinguishing between is an awareness of the National Performance Framework, which needs to be a kind of almost like a, you know, household understanding versus the household understanding should be that people should experience those outcomes, whereas in terms of the practitioner's awareness, it needs to be at a higher level than that household awareness.
You used the phrase, the ethos of the MPF there, and I think that touches on quite a lot of the feedback that we got when we were doing focus groups. The group that Daniel Johnson and myself spoke to ended up landing on the word implicit when we were asking about how their organisational plans and strategies align with the MPF. And my interpretation of that was that a lot of the people we were speaking to from a variety of public bodies used the MPF as a set of guiding principles, something that shaped the culture within their organisation, rather than, for the level they were at, it wasn't chief executive, senior managers on the whole that we were speaking to. The folk that we were speaking to are much closer to the level of delivery. For them, it was that set of guiding principles shaping their culture, rather than being able to rhyme off the specific outcomes and how they were contributing to them. Is that satisfactory to you? Is that, when we're talking about level of practitioners, that approach of being guided and having your kind of broad approach shaped by the MPF rather than being able to list off specific outcomes, is that what the government's looking to achieve here, or are you trying for a deeper level of, a more specific level of understanding than that?
I think that's good and beneficial, but probably not quite enough. And I think the terminology, the reason why I used the quote from North Ayrshire Council was that I thought in all the material that I looked at in preparing for this committee, I thought that quote where it talked about it forms the golden thread, it forms part of the golden thread linking national outcomes through to each employee's daily activities, best captured what are my aspirations here. It's not that people have got to rhyme off all of the national outcomes, but that their contribution to what they are doing is significantly guided by the aspirations of the National Performance Framework. And I thought that quote probably best expressed what the government is trying to achieve here.
Thanks. And just one final question. This is perennial one that's asked every time the government tries to get broad public engagement. How, through the review exercise that's about to take place, are you going to engage with those who, that overwhelming majority of the general public, who have absolutely no idea what the MPF is, who don't necessarily have an immediate and obvious relationship to delivery of MPF outcomes? How do you intend to engage with those who are otherwise disengaged from this, who don't work at the relevant level within a public agency or a third sector organisation?
Well, we need to undertake external engagement that will allow us to identify what type of country do people want to live in? Because that's the question that fundamentally drives the contents of the national outcomes. What type of country do people want to live in? And we need to hear that from members of the public as distinct from those who are the practitioners of delivering services or interventions. So fundamentally understanding what type of country do people want to live in should shape much of our thinking in this respect. And we'll do that by a range of engagement mechanisms, some of it may be by community gatherings, some of it may be by survey material, but we'll use different tools to gather that information.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Dan, to be followed by Liz.
Thank you. I just want to really go back to some of the points that the convener was raising, because I do think that ultimately for this to be successful, continue to be successful, this is about accountability and responsibility for taking it forward. And I think the thing that has struck me throughout our conversations is that there's actually a great deal of enthusiasm for this coming from places, you know, such as, I think, agencies, but actually particularly the third sector. But I think their observation is that's not necessarily reflected in what they are being asked to do. So your example of North Ayrshire Council, you know, we have had multiple accounts of organisations saying how they find it useful to consult the National Performance Framework, but then also saying that they're not necessarily being asked to frame their plans by government. So I wonder if there is a need to re-examine how sponsorship and ownership at a government level. I mean, do we need to be asking your colleagues around the cabinet table, for example, to make specific actions with regard to their portfolios? And indeed, one of the observations that has been made is that actually when you held both responsibility for the performance framework and the finance portfolio, that sort of glued the priority with this together with the money, which ultimately tends to drive things. And when things are split apart from the money, it doesn't need to. So do you think there needs to be a kind of a rethinking about responsibility at sort of ministerial level and indeed about where the performance framework is owned within responsibilities across government?
I don't think the particular solution that Mr. Johnson puts to me is necessary to do it, but I do think the point that underpins it is necessary, that there has to be, this has to be meaning. I think the point that Mr. Johnson is putting to me is this has to be meaningful in government. This has to influence decision making. And I agree wholeheartedly with that. And I think I think it does, but it probably, you know, government needs to look at whether it's as influential in decision making as it could and should be. The cabinet looks at performance and, you know, issues in relation to the National Performance Framework on a reasonably frequent basis. Cabinet is also looking extensively, and ministers are looking very extensively at the delivery of priorities. And of course, the delivery of priorities should be shaped by what are they contributing towards national outcomes and the National Performance Framework. Now, if we find ourselves taking decisions that are at odds with the National Performance Framework, well, that's a completely different question. That makes no, you know, that would be that would not be an appropriate place for us to be in. So we've got to be. So, you know, the committee may reflect on some of these things in its report. And I suppose that brings me back to the point that Mr. Mason raised with me about external scrutiny. You know, who is looking at what the government is doing and saying, actually, I don't think that's very consistent with the National Performance Framework. Well, parliamentary committees could say that to us. Audit Scotland could say that to us. But certainly, ministers are looking at these questions to be satisfied that we are taking decisions that are in line with the framework. The other perspective, though, and this is where I think Mr. Johnson has a fair point to put to me, if you take a perspective of a third sector organisation, I think third sector organisations will still feel that they are getting asked to do compartmentalised things rather than collaborative things, mm-hmm. if I can put it that way. I think they will probably feel they are still being asked to undertake transactions as opposed to provide holistic support to individuals. And that's an ongoing challenge within government, to move from the transaction to the holistic. And getting more to the holistic would get it more in line with the aspirations of the National Performance Framework.
I think the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Indeed, I would really recommend the Scottish Leadership Forum's work on how to actually apply the National Performance Framework. And indeed, I think they have done a level of work that goes beyond what the government has. And actually, on that note, I was just wondering if I could put three suggestions that have come up to the Cabinet Secretary. I think they make a lot of sense. So first of all, I think what John Mason was getting at in terms of responsibility is important. I don't think, though, in my view, it's wise to ascribe particular measures to particular organisations because of the nature of the measures. However, I do think that perhaps having a policy of asking either individual departments or when strategies are published, I think having a policy of greater explanation as to how they fit and contribute towards the National Performance Framework could be sensible. And I don't think that needs to be a statutory requirement. I think that could just be a matter of policy. But much like we do around sustainability targets, I think having that front and centre, making explicit almost the first and last thing that we're asking people in government to do and report against, I think would make a lot of sense. Likewise, another suggestion that came forward, again, to try and eliminate this issue of everyone agreeing in broad terms that the National Performance Framework is good, but no one actually taking specific responsibility for specific things, was the idea that you could have agreements between government and agencies where it's actually made a lot more explicit about the contributions. So that doesn't necessarily mean about having hard targets. A lot of that could be very much qualitative description, but very much, I think, putting in black and white some of those interdependencies and relationships that the Cabinet Secretary was just alluding to in terms of third sector organisations. So could those sorts of agreements that wrap around, sit on top of the sort of formal contractual agreements be one idea? And then thirdly, I think that the idea is that one of the points that was made a lot was that no one's going to disagree with any of the outcomes, that they're all good things, that they're pretty unobjectionable and unarguable. The issue actually comes with actually when you come up with plans about how to influence them, and that that is actually the difficult bit. So is there a need, rather than I think necessarily picking at individual targets, at the very least having a sense of a medium term plan about how certain things will be influenced within the framework, and indeed those other two points around reporting agreement would then flow from the plan that was in place to implement it, because otherwise simply having metrics without any sense of how you're going to influence them potentially is a recipe for making no progress at all. Mm.
I think the first thing I'd say is that I agree wholeheartedly with Mr Johnson's point about the Scottish Leadership Forum, which I think has, we essentially said to the forum, we need to translate the National Performance Framework and the achievement of outcomes into practical realities. And I think they've really advanced the thinking about that. And of course, that's a reflection. Scottish Leaders Forum is a collection of people who are influential in all this whole area of delivery. So I hope that gives the committee some confidence that practice is actually going on within different aspects of the public sector. I think there's an opportunity to ensure that we build on that work in responding to the points that Mr Johnson's put to me. I think we do need to be testing ourselves as to whether our actions are consistent with the National Performance Framework. When I read a cabinet paper which is developing a particular policy position, it will narrate the relationship between the policy intention and the National Performance Framework. But that has to be reflected all the way through. That's a policy development angle. It then has to be reflected in budget choices, operational decision making, because if I come back to some of the points that Michelle Thompson was putting to me, an approach which is based more on the, let me call it, the picking up the pieces rather than the early intervention, I think is going to be less aligned to the national performance framework than if it was on the side of the preventative interventions. So I think we've got to look at, in all aspects of policy making, where can we establish that alignment? I think there is an ongoing challenge about recognising the fact that solutions to issues that face members of the public are not generally found in neat little compartments. And government, of course, operates generally in neat little compartments, and I've said to the committee on countless occasions, I spend a lot of my time trying to overcome those neat little compartments. So if you take, for example, the formulation of the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, which was published by Shona Robison, behind that was an extensive amount of cross-governmental dialogue, which I chaired to make sure that the Child Poverty Delivery Plan was going to get cross-government intervention and support. So what came out was a collection of measures which looked at, yes, direct financial support to families, but also employability support and wider holistic support, which draws on transport, childcare, early intervention, mental well-being, counselling for people who are economically inactive. So you had actually a much broader plan. And to get to that point, that involved a lot of cross-ministerial dialogue to get to that point. Probably more than I think should be necessary, but it was necessary to get across all those compartments. And what we produced, I think, was a much broader and much more relevant intervention, which is much closer to the aspirations of the National Performance Framework than if we'd just left it to the compartment within government that's dealing with poverty, which is, well, formally dealing with poverty, which is Shona Robison's responsibilities. But if we're going to tackle poverty, that needs the work of education, it needs the work of health, it needs the work of transport, it needs the work of employability. It's not just in a neat little compartment. So I think in my explanation to the committee about the focus on the big themes of eradicating child poverty, economic recovery from COVID, net zero, these are all big issues being tackled on a cross-ministerial basis to give us some chance of making sure that our interventions are commensurate with the scale of the challenge. And then, lastly, Mr. Johnson asked me about essentially how to influence methods of achievement, and I think this is, you know, this is where I suppose I come back to where I started in this answer on the Scottish Leaders Forum. We've got to be turning this into practical reality, and we've also got to be operating in an empowered system. I don't think we need to be waiting just for Scottish leaders to say, we shall do this. Some of the best outcomes I've seen achieved have been members of the staff feeling as if they're confident in what they're doing to do the right thing and deliver better solutions for members of the public. And in so doing, I think they've been thinking about what they might not have been thinking, I must do this to satisfy National Outcome 5. I think they're thinking about what is expected of me through the national outcomes.
Just finally, I mean, ultimately, the success of this is largely reliant on the quality of the data that sits underneath it. But it's always struck me when I've looked at the National Performance Framework, when you click through it on the website, you get presented with lots of bullet points. It's actually probably more words than numbers, and it's not very digestible. I think there's a broader point around data, around kind of the you know, approaches and, you know, how you do that. But actually, just on a simple presentational point, do you not think that we need to do better at presenting the data? You know, I became a real kind of addict of the Public Health Scotland's dashboard through the pandemic. It was incredibly helpful for actually seeing what was going on. Do you think we need to have a bit of a refresh and have something similar for the National Performance Framework to actually bring the data to life?
I think there's I think we all were addicts of Public Health Scotland, believe you me. And I suppose there is there's an important point comes out of that. That was absolutely the focus for a certain amount of time, because COVID was the absolutely overwhelming issue. So what that tells us is that actually all this data that we might sometimes think, oh my goodness, people don't want to be able, want to plough through all this data. Actually, the experience of COVID was people did want to plough through that data because they wanted to know where we were heading. That's the crucial point. Where are we heading? So I think we've got to learn a lesson from that as we look at this material. And I think I've certainly been part of discussions which have wrestled with this question of data presentation on the National Performance Framework, where we've taken the view, oh, we can't present all that complex data because people will never plough their way through it. Whereas the example Mr. Johnson puts to me refutes that completely, because it mattered. So we've got to find a way of making sure we identify the data that matters. Now, we've had various attempts at this, you know, performance maintaining, performance worsening, performance improving. And there's vast data sets sit underneath that. But I think it's a fair point for us to explore as to whether or not there are actually a collection of data sets that really tell the picture about whether we're progressing. And, you know, some of those are to hand. You know, I'm mindful of the fact that colleagues wouldn't look at a GDP data and say, well, that's it. It's one of a number. But, you know, I can think of a number of particular data sets that I'm looking at all the time to make me think about, well, do I think Scotland is moving, are things moving in the right direction at this particular time? What am I troubled about? And we'll be looking at those data sets on a constant basis. So perhaps we need to draw them out and label them officially endorsed by Public Health Scotland, and everyone will look at them.
It'd be a good start. Thank you.
Okay, Liz, we're followed by Douglas.
Thank you. Mr. Swinney, can I ask you about what I think is a very important dilemma in all of this? And it's been raised by three sets of witnesses, one last week when we were taking evidence from Fife Council, one about 4 weeks ago when we were taking evidence from the third sector, and one at the workshop we had in Dundee. And these are all people, incidentally, who are broadly in favour of the, you know, the principles of the National Performance Framework. But there are also people who said that the best outcomes are those that are owned locally, when they, their own local communities have come up with ideas where they feel that they're making the best progress, when the local community, perhaps led by local government, has real ownership of what they're trying to do. And the dilemma is that if the best performances can be driven from a local, as in bottom-up, scenario, it may be that some of the outcomes, the projected outcomes in 11 in the National Performance Framework, get more of an emphasis in one region compared with another region, or one local authority compared with another local authority, and that others are less up the agenda for them. And I cite the example that Dundee City Council gave us, where they felt they were making very good progress when it came to tackling child poverty. But they said as a result of that, they weren't focusing on some of the other things. And so what I want to ask you about this dilemma, is it the case, as far as you're concerned, that you think some of the best outcomes are being driven by that local empowerment? In which case, does that challenge the need for quite such a prescriptive oversight from the national government about what it is we're trying to achieve?
I agree entirely about the importance of locally empowered solutions. And I think there's a lot of fascinating work going on just now. I'm very closely observing the work that's going on in Dundee and some of the pilots in relation to that complex relationship around employability, child poverty, employability, engagement in society, and there's some really interesting work emerging there. And it's emerging there, it's not emerging in other places. So that's and that's great, because that may then give us an approach to best practice which we can share with others, and we can begin to move on in that respect. So I think there's a really sound platform for that enables us to take that forward. That inevitably probably gives rise to the fact that greater emphasis is placed on some areas of activity than others, but then that would understandably be the case. I don't think, I'm interested in the characterisation that Liz Smith puts to this, that there is a prescriptive approach by government. I don't actually think there is a prescriptive approach here. Indeed, I think as I look at the evidence, some voices are saying the government needs to be more prescriptive because we need to, you know, we need to have folk absolutely complying with this and do. As you probably sense from the evidence I'm giving to the committee this morning, I'm not really persuaded by the get more prescriptive approach. I am much more interested in the let's make sure that people are empowered at local level to find the solutions that work out for them, providing they are contributing towards the national outcomes.
So if that's true, does that then imply that when it comes to accountability and measuring the outcomes, that the Scottish Government has to allow for that measurement and the ambitions to be developed from much more from a local perspective rather than from what some people have described, and they have used the word prescriptive, the 11 outcomes on a diagram. They feel that for their local communities, they can do things their way and to considerable effectiveness without having to worry too much about actually what the National Performance Framework says. And I've got some sympathy for that because, you know, certainly what I've seen, there are some examples of very good practice. But that good practice has not been informed by the National Performance Framework. It's been informed by what works for a local community. And, you know, last week in this Parliament, we were debating community wealth. You know, in principle, very good thing. We've obviously had the levelling up agenda. Very good thing in principle, even if we might debate about some other aspects of how these things run. And I think what I'm getting at with this dilemma is that for many local communities across Scotland, they feel that they have got an awful lot of ambition and talent and resources that they can best use if they're the ones that are the decision makers, rather than having to apply themselves always to a national performance framework. I think that's the issue.
I'm not sure that. I think we might be in danger of talking potentially across purposes here, because what I think that if a community is developing its approach to tackling child poverty, that is obviously going to be with the objective of eradicating child poverty, which is, of course, right at the heart of the National Performance Framework. So I think where Liz Smith might have a point in this is if the government was saying, you must do the following. The government's not saying that. The government is saying, we want to, by our collective efforts, eradicate child poverty. And the government will put in place certain things, but that's not exclusive. And if there's other things that you think can be done in your community, drawing on resources and capacity to eradicate child poverty, just you get on with it, and let's hope that that makes a big impact on the child poverty levels in the country. So it's not. So I think what the government is, the degree of prescription is the government saying, well, this is the type of country we're trying to create. and inviting a variety of organisations, private, public and third sector organisations, to work with us on that journey. What we're not specifying is you must do the following.
What would you say to, and I'm citing comments from the WISE group who've done some fantastic work, mm-hmm. and their point was that yes, the principles of the National Performance Framework are extremely important, but actually, if they're doing their job properly, they don't really need the National Performance Framework telling them what to do. They've got lots of examples, very collaborative, I may say, with the third sector, with local government and private sector. They feel that they have got enough examples of really good practice, which is helping to develop national performance outcomes, but they don't actually need it to do them in the first place, because if they're doing their job properly, it's there. And so from that observation, do we need to be slightly less prescriptive about the National Performance Framework so that people buy into the principles of it, but we don't actually have to set too many parameters about how it's delivered?
I think we come back at this point to a word the convener put to me at the very start of the session, which was the word patchy. I would be stunned if the WISE group found itself at odds with the National Performance Framework or the need to refer to the National mm-hmm. Performance Framework, because much of the practice of the WISE group over the last, I've known the WISE group closely for about 25 years, 30 years probably, and I think the thinking, ethos, outlook, perspective of the WISE group has heavily shaped the National Performance Framework. But I would also accept that there were some organisations in the country that are not operating at that level who need the National Performance Framework to give them a clear idea of where they should be heading. And so it's a bit of... on the specific example that Liz Smith puts to me, I don't think we've got anything to really teach the WISE group to any discernible extent, but I think there are other places in the country that would benefit from learning some of that experience.
So just to finish, you said something very interesting earlier on, where you said that if you didn't feel people were performing as well as they should be, then the accountability level might be raised slightly, so that there are sticks rather than carrots to get them to perform better. Is that something that the Scottish Government is seriously considering?
Well, I think there's a... if you look at... in our performance approach with organisations, we will put down challenging demands on organisations of what we expect of them. The government is not entitled to do that in relation to local government. But if you look at some of the comparative reports that the Accounts Commission do, the Accounts Commission look at individual local authorities, they will on occasion have some pretty bruising things to say to individual local authorities, and they may have some bruising things to say in a comparative sense. So there will be challenges to performance, and we should be willing to consider those challenges to performance.
Okay, thank you.
Douglas?
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Swinney, I just want to go back to the point about golden thread and local authorities. You mentioned North Ayrshire Council submission. Also had a submission from Fife Council. In their submission, it said, in terms of funding to the voluntary sector, we do not assess grant awards against their contribution to the national outcomes directly, nor do we map awards to the national outcomes that they contribute to. So I asked them about this, and they rightly said, well, what they do is it's mapped against their LOIP instead. And I think I made the point that
mapped against
the local outcome improvement plans instead of the local authority. And I made the point that I would see the golden thread would still flow, because of course the LOIP has to have due regard to the MPF. But I guess those third sector organisations may not actually. They'll be contributing to the MPF, but they're maybe not aware that they're contributing. Do you see that as a problem or not an issue at all?
I suppose the question it would raise for me is, are the local outcome agreements, are they genuinely contributing towards the expected outcomes of the National Performance Framework. I suppose that's what I would be. That's the question it would raise in my mind. Theoretically, mm-hmm. I can see exactly the point that has been made by Fife Council. But I suppose I would just have a question in my mind as to whether it all was as closely aligned as it is being expressed.
But would it be a problem that the voluntary organisation are not aware that they're actually probably making a good contribution to the MPF?
I would be, you know, I don't think it matters. No. Mm-hmm. As long as we're all operating in a way that is contributing constructively towards the direction of travel expressed by the National Performance Framework, I suppose that comes back to some of the earlier comments that I've put on the record today. If organisations are using public money and operating in a kind of contradictory fashion to the direction of travel, that would give me concern, mm-hmm. because I don't understand what the point of that is, because we've decided this is our direction of travel and this is what we should be aiming towards. Now, that doesn't mean to say every approach has got to be identical in every part of the country. It's not saying that in any shape or form. But we want to be satisfied that people are moving in a complementary direction to the National Performance Framework.
Mm-hmm. So you made the point that it's all fine as long as the LOIP does align with the MPF. So where is that check and balance done?
It's not done formally. But then I think if I was to look, for example, at an Accounts Commission report on an individual local authority, I'd be surprised if I didn't see some commentary about the degree to which the local authority was aligned in its planning and thinking to the National Performance Framework, because the Accounts Commission will be mindful from a regulatory perspective that is a relevant issue for them to consider.
Mm-hmm. So I guess that maybe ties into, so the Auditor General last year, he raised issues around accountability and delivery, and what he said was Scotland is suffering from a major implementation gap between policy ambitions and delivery on the ground. And he went on to say, I'm not convinced that public sector leaders really feel accountable for delivering change. So would you agree with that then? Or?
I don't think so, because I have, you know, I think if we go back to the point that I think Liz Smith made about the Scottish Leaders Forum, you know, that is generally made up of the public sector leaders in Scotland at operational level, not at political level. And you know, as I look at the work that comes out of that forum, I see those individuals very much signed up to the agenda that I've talked about extensively this morning, and recognising the fact that service changes have to be made, improvements have to be delivered to enable that to happen. So I don't really think there's an absence of engagement and accountability on these questions. I suppose the point I would make is that we have to be satisfied there is sufficient pace and intensity around about that work, and given some of the challenges that we face, that, for example, in child poverty, I want us to move at pace to eradicate child poverty. I think we'd have to ask ourselves, you know, do we think we're moving quite as fast as we could do, and all public authorities moving as fast as we could do?
So how could you increase that pace?
Well, that's about the political leadership that we need to put in place to move these organisations, and also potentially to think of different policy solutions to put in place which enable that to be the case, and to give greater priority to particular areas of policy than to others.
And is it, I think it was maybe Liz that suggested, you know, is that about looking at how they're funded and, you know, really, you know, using the carrot or the stick to make sure that they are aligned to the MPF?
There's always different approaches that can be taken. And I think what we have to satisfy ourselves is that organisations are operating with goodwill in a direction that will help us to achieve the national outcomes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, and that, thanks to colleagues around the table. I've just got one area I want to touch on, because it hasn't really been covered by the members of the committee. I mean, you talked about, obviously, delivery of priorities, and one of the focal points of the National Performance Framework is continuous improvement. But of course, it used to be more target-driven. And you just, in response to Douglas Lumsden, talk about the need to move at pace to eliminate child poverty. And you've also said you want to ensure that the outcomes are delivered in a less patchy form. But if we've got continuous improvement, what does that really mean? I mean, does that mean the government is satisfied with a 1% improvement a year, a 5%, a 10%? If we're not going to return to targets, would milestones be a more effective way of assessing where we were in terms of reaching each of the outcomes? And enable you to incentivise and encourage organisations more if, for example, some are not doing as well as they could?
I think there's a mixed picture on some of the requirements. You know, if you look, for example, at the issue of child poverty, we have statutory targets. Parliament has put into law statutory targets that have got to be achieved. The same exists on net zero. So there are certain elements that Parliament has already legislated for, and that's just a matter of fact that they have got to be achieved. So we have to have a degree of intensity that we believe is commensurate with achieving those targets. That won't, however, exist in all areas of policy, and I don't think it can exist in all areas of policy because we inevitably, I think, have to give more attention to some areas of activity than others. And the government has made its choices. We've made our choices around COVID recovery, child poverty, net zero. I think what the National Performance Framework helps us to do is to have as clear a shape and a concept of being able to judge whether or not progress has been made. Mr. Johnson put to me quite fairly the issues about data, and the National Performance Framework should enable us to look at that and say, well, here is the difference today compared with 12 months ago. Do we think that really is satisfactory on where the country is reaching just now? And I think that's a very important measure for us to take as a society and to be able to make a judgment about whether we've advanced as much as we would hope to have done.
I think that's a very fair point, but I mean, a number of organisations, a number of people, including myself, in that are goal and task driven, you know, and continuous improvement to one person or one organisation might mean something completely different to someone else, and that's where we come back to the issue of the delivery of the NPF being patchy. So that's why I mentioned milestones. Is there a way in which we can try and, if you like, square the circle of these two philosophies in order that we can optimise the response that we actually receive in terms of the delivery of the NPF?
I think we have to look at that question, Convener, because nobody wants this whole process to be vague. Mm-hmm. That's what we're trying to avoid. It has to not be vague, it has to be meaningful. It has to be meaningful and discernible. And I think there's a genuine effort being made by government to try to construct a national performance framework that enables us to do that. But we have the opportunity of the review that we will undertake, which will obviously reflect on the feedback from the committee and its inquiry, to judge whether or not there is more we could do in that respect. And I think the point you put to me is an important one that we consider.
OK, we'll finish on that point. I want to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for attending today, and indeed the Deputy First Minister for his very frank and detailed response to our questions. That concludes the evidence gathering for our National Performance Framework inquiry, and we'll consider a draft report after summer recess. We'll now take a short break until 10 past 11 before we move on to the next item of business, which is an evidence session with Skills Development Scotland. The next item on our agenda is today evidence from Skills Development Scotland on the trends behind the income tax forecasts. The session follows on from issues raised during our budget scrutiny 22-23. It also sets the scene for a pre-budget scrutiny this year, which will be informed with the Scottish Fiscal Commission's next forecast to be published later today. I welcome to the committee meeting Chris Brodie, Director of Regional Skills Planning and Sector Development, and Andrea Glass, Head of Regions and Enabling Sectors. Good morning. I understand Mr Brodie would like to make a short opening statement. Mr Brodie.
Yes, thank you. Good morning and thank you for the invitation to give evidence to the committee today. I'd like to begin firstly by thanking the committee for agreeing to reschedule this appearance, which was originally due to take place 5 weeks ago. After managing to avoid COVID for 2 years, I took a short trip to Spain and brought back an unwanted present, unfortunately, so very grateful for the rescheduling of this session. I'll just very briefly set some context for Skills Development Scotland. We're the National Skills Agency for Scotland, and we deliver a number of core services on behalf of Scottish Government. So we have over 800 career staff who are embedded in every secondary school in Scotland and work across a range of public access centres. We run the Modern Apprenticeship Programme on behalf of Scottish Government. We delivered over 25,500 modern apprenticeships last year, and we jointly deliver graduate apprenticeships and foundation apprenticeships with colleagues in the Scottish Funding Council. Andrea and I, the part of SDS that we work in, is the Skills Planning Directorate. We play a central role in working with employers to understand their skills needs now in the future. We develop a range of evidence and insights, some of which we've shared with the committee as pre-reading, and that essentially is cascaded out to training providers, colleges, universities, with the intention that that is used to inform skills provision in Scotland. And finally, we also have a small team who delivers direct support to companies to help them at an individual business level to understand their skills needs and look at upskilling and reskilling opportunities. Finally, just really important to say, we have a direct influencing role in a number of the areas that I've just described, but we also have an important indirect influencing role in respect to the skills system. So Scotland currently invests somewhere in the region of about £2.1-2.2 billion a year in post-16 education and skills. That's excluding the costs of student support. SDS's annual budget is in the region of £216 million out of that £2 billion. And we directly invest somewhere in the region of £85 to £90 million a year in terms of apprenticeships. So we look forward to giving evidence to the committee this morning and hope to be of help with your inquiry.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. So I'll start with some opening questions and then we'll go around the table. So firstly, I'd just like to say that the National Strategy for Economic Transformation was published on the 1st of March. And that included what is being described as five bold new policy programmes of action, including creating an entrepreneurial nation, developing new markets and industries, enhancing productivity and innovation, skills growth, and delivering high rates of employment and wage growth. So in the 3 months since that was published, just what, if any, has Skills Development Scotland done? What changes, if any, to its approach in order to take on board those priorities?
Thank you. I'll maybe begin and Andrea may come in with some follow-up. So I think the first thing to kind of recognise across the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, well, it has these five pillars, and you would think, you know, instinctively that the SDS's primary role would be around skills workforce. A skilled workforce is important to say we've got a role right across the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. So we're working with colleagues around the Young Persons Guarantee. The team that I mentioned that works directly with businesses is also supporting ambitions around new market opportunities in terms of inward investment. And we're also, that team also supports some of our work in terms of the business support partnership and direct support to businesses. Our primary areas of action are around the skilled workforce. So there are probably a couple of examples I will pick out. One of the named projects in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation is the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, which we launched on August the 23rd last year. I'll be in front of SDS's board next week talking about the development proposition for the second phase of the Green Jobs Workforce Academy. So at the moment, that provides a resource which connects people with emerging opportunities in relation to the transition to net zero. We expect that the scale of job opportunities that will emerge over the next 5 to 10 years will be significantly greater than we're seeing at the moment. So we're building both functionality into that resource and looking at how we align upskilling and reskilling support for individuals and for businesses through that work. Probably the other area that I'd point to, and this I think gets to the heart of the discussion today, I suspect, around productivity and skills. We're working very closely with colleagues in the Scottish Funding Council around the alignment of skills provision in Scotland's regions and for Scotland sectors behind the needs of the economy. So we've got some sectoral work, again, looking at the transition to net zero. We've got some work in the northeast of Scotland and the south of Scotland, which is working with education partners, the universities and the colleges, the regional economic partnerships, to ask that question, where do we think jobs are going? And is the skill system currently delivering against those ambitions and what we need to change?
So, you know, it seems to me that, you know, what you're basically saying is the strategy is based on a lot of the work that Skills Scotland is doing in terms of this area. Would that be right?
No, not
because that wasn't really what I was asking. I was asking basically what you were going to change or do differently as a result of the strategy. And you kind of talked about what has been done, for example, in terms of, you know, your green jobs programme from last August. So that's why I was wondering, has the strategy been built on some of your work, or, you know, or as opposed to the other way around?
I mean, I can maybe explain that slightly better than I did, convener. So a direct answer to your first question, yes, like other public agencies, we were involved in the discussions to shape the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. Some of the areas that I picked out were deliberately referencing some of the actions that have been identified. I think there are 78 actions across the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. What I was looking to do was to pick out some of those actions that specifically relate to our work in SDS, mm-hmm. And give the committee of a sense of the progress that we're making in relation to those actions. You're quite right to point out that the Green Jobs Workforce Academy is something that predated the publication of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, but I think the importance of that work and the potential contribution that it can make is one of the reasons why it's a named project.
Now, the UK unemployment rate is about 3.7%, and in Scotland it's a record low of 3.2%. But is that actually a realistic figure, for example? In terms of those who are in employment, and we understand that the number of people that are economically inactive in Scotland is more or less the same as the UK, it's 75.6%, 1.1% lower than the UK. But is it realistic in terms of full-time involvement in the economy? What percentage of these people are economically less than fully active, i.e. working part-time? And is there a hidden unemployment? I understand that Sheffield Hallam University produced a study to say that we're actually more than 1 million people who are actually not working, who should really be included in the figures but are not. So where are we in terms of the reality of the picture? Because it looks much rosier, I think, on paper than it probably does in reality, and I think a lot of that is possibly because of, at a time of a huge number of vacancies, a skills and geographic mismatch.
Thank you. There's a lot in that question, and I'll try and kind of pick my way through it, and I'll warn the committee this is an area that I have been known to talk about at great length, so I'll try and be brief. So I think the first thing to say is you're absolutely right in terms of that characterisation of the headline figures. So adult unemployment is at a historical low. Youth unemployment in Scotland is remarkably low. It's something like 5.6% at the moment. But I agree with you. I'm not sure that tells the full story of what's currently going on in our labour market at the moment. So economic inactivity is somewhere in the region of about 21.4%. I think you have slightly earlier figures. We updated our COVID labour market insights yesterday. And that has actually now closed that economic inactivity rate to close to the UK average as well. If you look at the long term, the issue that we have in Scotland is about rising or fairly stable economic inactivity, and I'll come back to that in a moment. There's a flip side, I think, of the labour supply perspective, and that's what's going on in the economy. And in short, every indicator that I look at in terms of the jobs market suggests that we've got a very hot labour market at the moment. And at a certain, you know, from a certain perspective, that is a good thing. The number of vacancies that we're seeing posted is high. It's higher than it was pre-pandemic. We're seeing lots of evidence around employers having challenges in terms of recruitment. So that kind of turns, I suppose, you may not have asked this question, but I may offer what you can do around that. I think we need to think differently about the labour supply challenge. And part of that is about looking hard into that economically inactive. And you're right to point out that a significant proportion of that group, I think from the top of my head, the number is about 110,000 out of the 230 in Scotland, they're looking for work. I think we need to reframe our thinking about this group and say, how do we get these people back into the jobs that we know employers are looking to recruit into at the moment because they're having difficulties. I think there's other dimensions to it as well around demographics and around some of the implications of what's going on in the skill system around the pandemic. But I would agree with the premise of the question. Driving into economic inactivity is really important because these are people who would want to work if they could find a job, I suspect. But we know that employers are having difficulties recruiting.
Okay, and two parts of that question. I mean, it was quite an extensive question, so I do apologise for that. It was about part-time working. Where are we in terms of the proportions in part-time working? And the other thing is the geographic balance. So, for example, I represent a constituency, you know, in North Ayrshire where, you know, the market isn't particularly hot relative to, for example, Edinburgh. And there's a kind of concern, certainly by myself and other colleagues in West Scotland, that there's more of an East Coast east-west divide in Scotland. It might be north-south in England, but it seems to be east-west and certainly in Scotland. So it's about how we actually address those specific challenges. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, so you can look at Scotland and talk about percentages, but there's marked differences between different parts of the countries, I'm sure you're well aware.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll begin just in terms of part-time workers. I have an extensive briefing in front of me that has just about every statistic you could imagine in the labour market, but not in part-time workers. So I will undertake to provide some written input into the committee after the appearance. You're right to point out the difference in terms of unemployment rates across the country. And I think for a long time there has been the emergence of a kind of east-west divide in Scotland, both in terms of population growth, in terms of economic growth, in terms of unemployment. I think at the heart of this, but sorry, before I go on to talk about this, the heart of it, that picture is beginning to change. So one of the bits of data that we have been tracking since about 2014-15 is the change that's taken place in the northeast. So, typically 10 years ago, whenever I visited Aberdeen, you know, the flipping comment was you could count on one hand the number of people who were unemployed in the North East because of the buoyancy of that labour market. That's not the case now. You know, the North East is now moving back towards the national average. So that East-West kind of breakdown is breaking down. I'll turn to Andrea a moment in terms of some of the things that we might do around it. But at the heart of the matter for me are kind of three issues. You know, in terms of those areas that have got significant unemployment, how do you ensure that you've got the conditions to create good quality jobs? Secondly, it's recognising, particularly in a North Ayrshire context, that you're 20, 30 minutes away from a really strong labour market in the wider Glasgow City region. So, you know, I think the transport infrastructure plays an important role in connecting people to jobs, but really the important thing is around skills, and that's where I go back to the focus on, you know, both skilling, reskilling and upskilling people for the jobs of today rather than the jobs of 20 years ago, and also looking at how we improve people's employability skills. Andrea, I don't know if you have anything you wish to add.
I think it's worth just noting that obviously the work that is done around regions and through the regional economic partnerships is very, very important. The SDS regional skills planning leads, they manage the relationships with our regional partners right across Scotland, and part of that is about understanding in those localities, within the regions and within the local authority areas, where the challenges actually lie. And it's very important that what we have is a really, really good evidence base of understanding what the problem is that we're trying to solve. And it's on that basis, I think, that local partners can come together to begin to address the challenges, be they unemployment or otherwise, within a particular locality. Because that's having that really, really strong evidence base is how we can begin to make sure that we're solving the right problems because we've actually identified the challenges that we're facing.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, the reason I asked about part-time is because many people do prefer working part-time, but a lot of people work part-time because they don't feel that there's a full-time job, perhaps, in their area which they're qualified or skilled for. And talking about skills, actually, I went to visit one of the major employers in my constituency, National Apprentice Week, and I talked to a number of apprentices, and all of them said the same thing to me, which was that when they actually were thinking about a career post-school, they were all being told, they say, by their careers advisors, that if you didn't go to university, you're a failure. You know, if one person says that to you, take it as anecdotal. If a whole wean of people tell you that, you think there's really an issue there. And you said earlier in your opening statement, you've got 800 careers advisors in Scottish schools. So I'm just wondering what kind of message is being told to people and younger people about that, because quite clearly we have a huge shortage of... I mean, we're trying to build more houses in Scotland, but we need more roofers, plasterers, you know, electricians, you know, plumbers, you name it. I mean, as well as engineering skills, as well as people getting STEMs, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, if everyone's going to university, we know there's a shortage of people who will then be able to go and carry out these apprentices, especially as we don't have the same number of migrants coming into the country and the birth rate is at an historic low. So it's a kind of perfect storm that we're actually facing in the years ahead.
Yeah, just to respond immediately to the comment around careers advisors, I would say that the issues that influence young people's career choices are wider than careers advisors. They're teachers, their parents, their peers and careers advisors.
Of course.
I can assure you that our careers advisors in Skills Development Scotland do not push that message that if you do not go to university, you're a failure. It's really important that we communicate to young people the range of choices that are available, and we deliver modern apprenticeships. So if there is a careers advisor pushing that message, I'd like to meet them. That sounds very threatening, but yeah. I just don't think it's a message we'd be looking to put out. In terms of that, through SDS careers advisors, I think, again, you hit on a really important point, and it's a real paradox when you look at some of the data that we're looking at. We have got significant skill shortages, labour shortages, rather, at the moment, for all the reasons you describe. Part of it is also around older workers leaving the labour market as a result of COVID. At the same time, we have got record numbers of people going into further education, higher education. And that is not in any way to be a denigration of further education or higher education. I think one of the really interesting innovations that we've introduced into the system with the SFC is the notion of graduate apprenticeships. So you can get a higher level qualification while you are in the workplace. And I think that also has the added benefit of equipping young people and letting employers see the quality. You know, they can get young people working in the way of that business, and it lets young people get an opportunity to earn while they learn. So I would be in agreement with the points broadly that you've made.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, I didn't really think your career advisors were saying that, but that is indeed the message I think a lot of younger people are picking up, and I've raised it at a number of other different fora because I think it's certainly something the schools perhaps need to address more directly. I know that when I've held employment fairs, you know, some schools have been very snotty about sending kids along, even the kids who actually are not even going forward for exams, never mind who are likely to go to university. I think graduate apprenticeships is hugely positive, but I just want to stick on demography for a wee bit longer, because the figures are actually quite stark. You know, by 2045, the people pensionable age in Scotland expect to increase by 21%, and the workforce decline by 2%, and the number of children by 22%, again showing what the long-term situation is going to be, with 192,000 fewer people in the working age population. So the economy is going to have to be a lot more productive just to keep, well, all the people in this room, well, we're all a lot older 25 years from now, apart from anything else. But we go on to look at the migration figures, and I just want to ask you specifically about these migration figures, because they're slightly ambiguous, because you talk about almost twice as many people have left Scotland and moved overseas, 31,300 out migration in 2019-20 compared to 19,700 in 2018-19. So when you talk about overseas, do you include England in that, or are you just talking about beyond the United Kingdom? Because, you know, last year the birth rate in Scotland was 48,000. So if we're losing 31,000 people, That's pretty disconcerting at a time when the workforce is shrinking already. And what is the kind of age, skills and educational profile of the people who are leaving Scotland? Because my concern, as I've expressed in this committee before, is that many people sometimes come to Scotland to retire here, but we're losing a lot of people in their 20s and 30s who are moving to the rest of the UK or beyond. Lastly on that question is, what are we doing to attract more people from the rest of the United Kingdom to live and work in Scotland? Sorry, that was a lot, but I'm so much to ask on this. I'm trying not to ask everything, but...
So I'll maybe pick up on a couple of elements of that. Firstly, in relation to what's going on in demographics, and secondly, what's going on in terms of migration, and then thirdly, around what we might do around that. So, you're right. Scotland's demographic profile has been challenging for a number of years and will continue to be challenging for the next 20 years. And that is a consequence of, as you alluded to, the falling birth rate. We're not uncommon across other OECD countries or developing countries. This sounds very blunt. There's very little you can do about that now. So we will deal with the consequences of, you know, low birth rates 20 years ago for another 20 years. Mm. I think the really interesting story is around migration in Scotland. And prior to 2018, the Scottish population overall grew by about 290,000 people. So 290,000 more people in Scotland than there were in 2008. 90% of that was due to in-migration. And 50, you know, you could almost cut that perfectly in half. Half was from the rest of the UK, half was from the EU. So about 145,000 people moving north, 145,000 coming in from the EU. The consequences of both Brexit and the pandemic have really turned that flow down to a trickle. And they are related. So firstly, in terms of COVID, we've got lots of evidence that lots of EU nationals went back home to Europe to see out the pandemic, and then maybe were perhaps unable to get back into the country because of changes in immigration rules. Secondly, and this sounds an obvious point when I say it, but I think it's important to bear in mind, the entire global economy and people stopped moving for 2 years. So I think it's too early to say whether the levels of migration that we're seeing in 2021 are typical of what we're seeing in future years. What I can say with some confidence is that, you know, that flow of in-migration, which was typically of younger people, typically of working age, typically higher skilled, typically more likely to be engaged in the labour market, that has slowed down considerably in the last 4 years as a result of COVID and Brexit. The question, what do you do in terms of turning around that challenge of working age population, is a question that Scottish Government is wrestling with. And they published a population strategy, I think, in 2019, end of 2019, early 2020. For obvious reasons, in relation to the pandemic, that hasn't progressed. It has picked up pace significantly over the last 6 months. It looks at measures that you can take to increase the birth rate through, you know, creating a good environment for people to have families. That's a long-term intervention. It's looking at an approach in terms of talent attraction, which is being clear about what sorts of skills we want to recruit and bring into Scotland. And that could be from, you know, recognising that carers is an important part, or health workers might be an important part of the mix, or we might be looking to go after, for example, digital technology skills and life sciences skills. So that linking to the inward investment strategy, linking to the national strategy for economic transformation priorities, is a key part. The really important part for me is about how you action that. And just before the pandemic, I had the good fortune to visit Copenhagen to look about how they go about talent attraction. It's about selling, you know, the distinctive kind of qualities of Scotland in terms of quality of life, in terms of employment opportunities, in terms of a place to bring up your kids. It's critically about having that focus on knowing who you're going after. It's also about not just marketing to individuals, but actually then following up and ensuring that you land that lead, for want of a better term, And finally, the proposals around a talent attraction service also envisage some kind of settlement support for people who are coming into the country, whether that's from whether it's from Bromsgrove or whether it's from Barcelona. So that's the approach that is underway in Scotland at the moment.
Just a couple of things, and I realise I asked quite a lot in that question. You know, a couple of points you didn't really touch on there in your answer, which is the age profile of people leaving Scotland and whether overseas includes, you know, includes UK, because it doesn't really give us a clear picture. The word overseas, I don't really know what that means there. Is it people leaving Scotland or just leaving to go beyond the United Kingdom? So it's about that. And the other thing as well is, I mean, I think, you know, attracting people to Scotland, you know, when you get so many people leaving Scotland, you know, is like trying to fill a sink with a plug out, you know. So, I mean, I think retaining people in Scotland is half the battle, surely, particularly given I believe that there's a disproportionate number of educated and highly skilled people leaving, best people, whatever you want to call them. I mean, a number of people I know who've got, a son who's an oncologist in Sydney, or an IT consultant in Boston or whatever it is. And I don't mean Boston Lynx, I mean Boston over in the States, whatever. You know, it's quite incredible the number of people, you know, and Scotland continues to export very talented people. So it's about those issues as well, you know, retention as well as attraction.
So a clarification, those numbers I was quoting were around net migration. So you're right, migration's complex. There's flows out the country, there's flows into the country. The figures I was quoting in terms of 290,000 over 10 years, that's a net figure. So that's the difference between those who left and those who came in. I think the other thing I would say is that the data on migration is patchy and not great. So it's a bit of a kind of treasure hunt to actually put a shape on it. I think I would offer two very quick observations. Almost as important are the flows within Scotland. So I've done a lot of work down in the south of Scotland with SOCI and also up in the Highlands and Islands. And the Highlands and Islands is fascinating. Population's grown by 6-7% over the last 20 years, but that's primarily been as a result of older people moving there to retire, as you described. So, you know, the work that partners are undertaking there is about, you know, looking at UHI as an asset to actually retain people in the region. We've done some work with Western Isles Council where we scoped the career ambitions of every person in school from S4 to S6. We designed foundation apprenticeship offers around there linked to provision at the college. So you're right, we need to have a focus on retaining people in Scotland, but we also need to have a focus in, you know, retaining and anchoring skills in Scotland's regions. And I think to come back to the pandemic again, the opportunities that digital connectivity offers, the breaking of the link necessarily between where you live and where you work, presents some opportunities, I think, to do things differently going forward.
Okay, there's loads of things I want to talk about, but I'm not going to, because colleagues want to come in. So I'm just going to ask one final thing before I open out to colleagues around, because there's so much here to get our teeth into. One of the things here is that you've talked about is a number of inactive people discouraged has risen sharply during the pandemic, which is starting to fall. And I thought, discouraged, what does that mean? So I looked at, point 22, which says, those who are not looking for work because they believe no jobs are available. Now, I find that quite astonishing in that situation, given that, you know, we've got to get record levels of vacancies in the economy, and there's, you know, from every aspect of the economy seems to have a chronic shortage. I mean, for example, you know, our airports, and not so much in Scotland, but south of the border, have been clogged up, not just because of shortage of air crew, but, you know, even people at security, in baggage handlers, etc., etc. So all levels of skill, one would think. So is this situation continuing? Is it subsiding? Where are we on that discouragement? And just one last thing in terms of productivity, working from home. There are different reports on whether working from home increases or decreases productivity, or whether a hybrid model, in actual fact, is the best of both worlds. What's Skill Development Scotland's view on that?
Okay. I'll pick up on the economic inactivity and the discouraged workers and say a couple of very brief things about it. So if you look at the economic inactivity numbers, the numbers of people who are discouraged are relatively small in comparison to other groups. So part of my response to that is say I think we need to look elsewhere at looking where the big challenges are around economic inactivity. The big growth's been in people who are inactive because they're long-term sick and people who've gone on to study. The other thing I would say about that group, and you're right, I look at these numbers all the time, and that's one that makes me scratch my head. So when we've got a position where we've got a hot labour market, we've got lots of jobs, we've got lots of recruitment difficulties, why are people thinking there are no jobs that are available? What my colleagues tell me who crunch these numbers is that that group is typically, the language they use is fluid and responsive to labour market conditions. To put it into layperson's terms, that group will get smaller as people recognise that the labour market is in a better position. So I suspect it's I don't want to say a red herring, but for me it's probably not the most critical issue in relation to economic inactivity, because that group does grow and expand over time quite quickly. There was a second part to the question, which, forgive me, I've forgotten.
I've forgotten as well, actually, I think about it. No, I think it was just about basically discouragement, etc. I was asking about, you know, why there are so many people and what's been done. Oh, you've answered that one, the second one I went on to. That's the thing when you think on your feet, it's you don't write things down, isn't it? Sorry. Oh, yes, either. But working from home, yes, Tales of Scotland carried out any research on whether working from home is more productive, working in the office, so to speak, is more productive, or a hybrid model of the two.
I think the best way probably to respond to this is to talk about the approach that we're taking as an organisation. Mm-hmm. So we flipped on March the 16th, like everyone else, from being an organisation that was full in the office to fully at home. Within, I think, about 48 hours. And we've had 2 years of pretty much working from home. Indeed, the last couple of committee appearances I've done have been from the comfort of my spare room rather than in the committee. The approach that we're taking in SDS is actually about testing the benefits that we're going to get from hybrid working. I think we've recognised that for employees and for colleagues, there have been lots of benefits from hybrid working. I think from a productivity view, and I'm interested in Andrew's and my team, should we give you a different view, but when I look at the volume of work that we've got through as an organisation, it has been significant because of the pandemic, because we haven't been travelling to meetings, we haven't been personally travelling all over the country. So I think there are some big efficiency gains, for want of a better term, that home working brings. At the same time, you miss out on interaction with colleagues, you miss out on creative thinking around new ideas, you miss out on kind of project start, project completion. So I think it's too early to say about whether it's going to improve productivity. My gut tells me that a hybrid model will, but it's maybe one for me to come back on in about 2 or 3 years' time and say, how's it worked out?
Okay, just to ask Andrew if she's got anything to add to that.
Yeah, certainly. I think given that a lot of my team are out in the regions, particularly those who are in Highlands and Islands or those who are in the south of Scotland, I think they have found some significant benefits in a sort of hybrid working model where they are not having to travel to huge distances for meetings all of the time. And it's allowed more people to actually be focused by, you know, actually when there's a meeting that they need to be at, they can do it in a virtual sense, and then they can take a judgment that if they absolutely need to be in the room for those benefits that Chris has mentioned around that social interaction or workshopping ideas or whatever that might be, then they're able to be there. I do think there are benefits as well in terms of the green agenda by not travelling so much. It enables organisations to be able to demonstrate their commitment to net zero. So that's something I think that's very important for us and also for our partners. I suppose the one challenge that I see around it is the fact you're expected to be there 24/7, and you know there is perhaps some concerns if you're always undertaking work online. You don't have those breaks that perhaps you do some of the time in the office, and that can be a little bit challenging. But I think on balance that the hybrid working model will work, and it will give opportunities for balance.
Okay, well, let's open out the session. Ross, to be followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to come back to the Sheffield Hallam University study that the Convener mentioned around hidden unemployment, I think was how they phrased it, and specifically the million people who are on incapacity benefits. And I should preface this by saying they make very clear in the report there's no suggestion that there are large numbers of people on incapacity benefits who shouldn't be. It's not about fraud. People who are on incapacity benefits do have legitimate incapacities, and that's why. But the basic thrust of that report is that there's a large number of people who are on incapacity benefits because they don't feel that they're able to get employment, or they are searching for employment, but while they're searching for it, this is the most appropriate social security for them. The subset of that for Scotland is about 100,000 people. Do you have any data on how many of the 100,000 or so people in Scotland who are on incapacity benefits would like to be in employment?
I do somewhere, if you give me a moment.
Absolutely, thanks.
Of course, now that I'm looking for it, I can't find it. If I can maybe just try to pick up on that, and we can follow up in terms of that specific data, and
yeah,
Andrea may find it as she's looking through the briefing papers. I think this, as I've said already, I think there's a real imperative from a labour market perspective about looking about how we re-engage people who are described as economically inactive back into the workplace. I would also just be clear that in terms of what we deliver as an agency, that's not a service area where we have specific training or opportunities. We work with colleagues in local authorities and other partners in that respect. I also think there's a kind of important driver for business here to recognise that this group of people are a potentially important kind of source of skills and talent to fill labour shortages. And I think part of that is about businesses recognising the point that was made by the convener earlier, that a job that needs to be filled may not need to be filled full time. A job that needs to be filled, employers may find that by offering reasonable adjustments that don't necessarily impact on the business but facilitate ease of access to jobs for people on incapacity benefit is a good way of kind of plugging gaps. And Andrew, I don't know if you've tracked down the figure.
I'm afraid not.
It was a very specific figure to ask for, so no worries about not having it immediately to hand. If you could follow up in writing,
I'll find
that,
it on the
great.
Train, no doubt, on the way back to Glasgow, but I can offer to provide that in writing to the committee again.
Thanks very much. And just one follow-up in this area, in terms of availability of that data, and I acknowledge what you've just said, if this is not one of SDS's primary or core responsibilities, but if you were to conduct further research into that group of around 100,000 people, do you have sufficient data available to you? Do you have the ability to contact those people directly, or is this something that you would have to go through the UK DWP for?
No, so kind of two parts to that question, and part of my frustration is we spotted this issue in terms of economic inactivity at our board about 6-7 months ago, and I have a detailed report, a deep dive on economic inactivity that we can summarise and share with the report, share with the committee that was shared with our board. Coming back to economic inactivity, it's important to recognise that the economically inactive are made up of a range of different kind of groups of people. So you're right to focus in on getting people back into work who might want to and who have long-term limiting health. That number's gone up quite significantly during the pandemic. The numbers of students in FE and HE has also gone up during the pandemic. And those are the two groups that account for most of that change. I've done it again. I've forgotten the second part of your question. Apologies.
It was around the ability for you to conduct further research in this area.
Sure.
Do you need to go through UK DWP or do you have access to all the information you already need?
So while I said SDS doesn't have a direct service delivery role, we don't run the Employability Fund anymore. One of the services, I suppose, we run on behalf of partners is the 16 Plus Data Hub. So working in collaboration with DWP, with local colleges, with schools, with universities, and using anonymised data, we can track where every young person aged 16 to 24 is in terms of their journey, either through the education system or through their engagement with employment. And that information is shared with partners. So we identify young people in particular who are at risk and share that information from partners. That data set doesn't extend out to the economically inactive, but I suspect, I don't know for sure, but I suspect DWP will be aware of who those individuals are and will be working with those individuals either on a one-to-one or on a group basis.
Thanks. And just one final question, somewhat related to that. You mentioned just there, economic inactivity rates have gone up in part because of the high numbers of young people in Scotland who are in FE and HE. Now, the net result of that is that we do have, on the whole, a highly educated population. And yet, one of the most perennial bits of feedback that we get from employers, and I remember it from 10-plus years ago when I was at the senior phase of high school, and it's still the case now, is that they can't find, not just the young people, they cannot find people with the right skills. Now, taking aside kind of specific skill shortages of can't find enough people who are qualified plumbers or electricians or radiographers, there's the other element to that, which is kind of general employability skills, the ability to work as part of a team, good communication skills, etc. I realise this is a very broad question to ask, but why, when we have such a highly educated population, such high levels of participation in not just reaching the senior phase of high school, but in FE and HE as well, do we have this perennial issue of employers saying that the skills just aren't there? And, again, I should preface that by saying I acknowledge, I'm enthusiastic support of the idea education is not just about employability. People are going to FE and HE for all sorts of other reasons. But it still seems odd that we've got this disconnect, huge participation in further and higher education, and yet employers saying the skills still aren't there.
It's a great question, and it's quite a kind of challenging and emotive subject, so I'm going to kind of preface this by saying Scotland's colleges and universities are a huge asset to the country, and particularly in terms of education, in terms of research. At the heart of this for me is we often make the mistake of equating high levels of qualifications with high levels of skills. And I think they're two quite different things. Yeah. To pick on a couple of examples, and this is going back to some of the sectoral work that Andrew and colleagues on my team did a number of years ago. We were looking at skills for the life sciences sector, and Scotland's university system turns out high quality graduates, but their capabilities in terms of lab skills were not there. So, our approach to that was firstly to kind of run a 16-week retrofitting course, for want of a better term, about putting these lab skills into graduates. That then was taken up as part of the curriculum by universities who were teaching graduates. So you see a problem and you resolve it. I think for me, the work that we're doing with colleges and with the Scottish Funding Council, particularly through some of the National Strategy Economic Transformation projects, are about looking at the skill system on the ground, recognising that we've got assets, but asking that question, how do we better align it behind the needs of industry so that the gap that you describe doesn't emerge? I think it is about aligning behind where jobs are going to be rather than where they were. So it is about more courses in areas around the green transition. It's more courses in areas around digital, where we know the economy is going to grow. I think we need to look at the quality, not the quality, the depth of the curriculum. And the example I've given around life sciences is replicated across a range of other courses. Get industry engaged in designing curriculum. You get graduates who are more ready for industry. And the final thing, and I would say this, wouldn't I, because I work for Skills Development Scotland, but look at the data. Our competitors, our comparators in the OECD, who don't have that gap between qualification and skills, have got much more workplace learning, where apprenticeships are not, as was described by yourself, the perceived as the second choice, but they're a fundamental part of the skills system. And the final part of that is about upskilling and reskilling. The economy and the labour market has changed massively over the last 2 years. It ain't going to slow down over the next 10. So how do we keep worker skills up to date, I think, is a key question for us.
Thanks very much. Sorry, Andrea.
As well, it's probably worth remembering the importance of meta skills, the sort of higher order, sort of timeless skills that are there to enable individuals right from school age and on into the labour market to become adaptive learners. In whatever sort of context the future brings, then those meta skills are really, really important, and they need to be embedded in all sorts of provision and learning, because that's what enables individuals to be able to respond to the challenges that we'll be facing in the future.
I'd love to get into more detail on that, but I think I'd be at risk of wearing my other committee hat, which is the Education and what was the Education and Skills Committee, so perhaps another time.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you, John, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I take your point, as you just answered, that there's a difference between skills and education. However, are we actually sending too many people to university?
That's a great question that's put me right on the spot. And surprisingly, the answer I'm going to give you is I don't think it's as simple as that.
Okay.
As I said earlier, I think Scotland's universities are a huge asset for Scotland in terms of the research capability, in terms of providing a pipeline of talented, capable graduates. They're also a big draw for international students kind of into the country. And I think there's a bit we need to think about how we lock some of those international, lock's not the right word, how we keep some of these international students working in Scottish businesses. I think the issue we have is around the nature of the journeys that young people take through the education system, and in some cases, the length of time it takes them to go through. So part of the reason we are sending so many people to university, as you put it, is that the college system has increasingly become a route through which you get entry to university. So the college system, in part, it's producing people who've got skills to go straight into work, but it's increasingly becoming a route through which people get the qualifications to go on to university study. I think the other nuance to the conversation is just that, as I've alluded to, is about recognising that the skills that we need to be teaching in our colleges and universities need to be aligned to the future. I would offer one observation without answering the question directly and getting me into some difficulty, but if you look back 30, 40 years ago, there are a number of professions where you now need to go through university, for example, in accountancy, where traditionally the route of gaining those skills was in the workplace. And that's why, with the Scottish Funding Council, we're looking almost to reintroduce the concept of an on-the-job learning through graduate apprenticeships delivered by universities, getting people into the workplace.
No, I mean, I do think that's a fair point. It's not as simple as maybe I was suggesting, and being an accountant, actually. I think that the idea of modern graduate apprentices is an extremely good one. I mean, you talked about aligning with the needs of the future or words to that effect. I mean, I'm not asking you to do this, but I mean, how easy is it for anyone to predict what we're going to need in the future? Presumably that's why we're having the census, so I should put a plug in for people completing that today. But, I mean, in my lifetime, or, while I've been here, I mean, we've had some years and they've said, oh, we've trained too many teachers, and then another year we've trained not enough teachers, and the same with nurses, and probably the same with a few other things. I mean, is that an incredibly difficult thing to predict?
It's not easy. I'll say that. Predicting the future is not what our forecasting work is about. The minute you write a forecast down, you're guaranteed to be wrong to some level of degree. I think I have this debate regularly with college principals and with college and the skills system. We commission a set of national forecasts every year, and we cascade them out into the skills system. Is that because I believe they're going to tell me that we need 12 plumbers in Lerwick next Thursday? No, it's not. But what it does show me is directionally where there are potentially going to be pressure points in the economy. And I think that's an important thing for skills providers to understand. Probably the depth of our work is actually about engagement with employers. So I think it's one thing to know that there's pressure in the oil and gas sector or the engineering sector, but you need to understand what's driving that pressure and where the pinch points are in terms of skills. So I have a team of sector leads work across 16, 17 different industries in Scotland. And underpinning the forecasts is a readout, which again we share with colleges and with universities and with training providers, that say, in digital skills, in the digital arena, the issues are around, cloud computing, they're around, I'm going to get it wrong, but they're around cloud computing, they're around, whatever the specific skill needs are. So it's not just about making a forecast, it's actually about putting some meat behind that and saying what employers tell us we're missing are the following things. The challenge, of course, is the speed at which the skill system can respond to that. And I think, again, one of the things that, that is highlighted in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation and that we firmly believe in is the old models of 2-3 year courses are not going to work in a fast changing labour market. Yes, there's absolutely a role for them, but we need our assets and our world-class assets to be focusing on upskilling and on reskilling. And there's already, you know, lots of evidence across the pandemic of universities and colleges moving their provision online. So I think the ingredients are there in Scotland to really capture that challenge.
Okay. On another area, are we making any progress in getting more women into certain professions or just generally into across society? I mean, we've often heard figures that, you know, if women were setting up businesses at the same rate as men, the economy would be just so much better off, and I suspect that applies to other sectors as well, if there was more women high up in engineering and all sorts of places.
Well, there's certainly a lot of challenge in that particular area, and I think the reason for that is because what can be argued is that we are underutilising the potential of the workforce if we don't have everybody in there being able to uptake the opportunities that are actually there. We know that inequality is a potential drag in terms of economic growth, and so we really need to be looking at how we can get more women engaged in terms of in the labour market. We have to be clear about opportunities. We have to work to break down barriers. Why is it? Do we understand the reasons that sit behind why women are not perhaps engaging or why startups numbers are not so high? And we have to make sure we've got the right support in place once the individuals are actually in the workforce. You know, are we offering the right conditions in terms of flexible work practices, in terms of access to relevant training to allow women to take up these opportunities? In terms of the actual numbers themselves, that's not something I have the detail on. Chris, I don't know if there's anything you could add around that.
No, I mean, what I would say, and again, we can follow up with some specifics in the data. I mean, one of the challenges in terms of apprenticeships, and particularly in kind of trade apprenticeships, is that, you know, we've had significant kind of gender imbalances, and they're obvious ones. You know, hairdressing qualifications are much more likely to be undertaken by women, and construction qualifications are more likely to be undertaken by men. We've had a significant body of work over the last kind of 5 years to address that. We've appointed a senior advisor in terms of qualities to look at what we can do around our apprenticeship programme. And I know that we've made some progress, not in eradicating those kind of imbalances, but in changing the dial in terms of closing that gap between male and female participation in some frameworks. I think one of the things we've also kind of learned about that is that, you know, these are issues that have a societal route rather than necessarily the design of our frameworks.
Yes, well, I was going to ask that in a kind of supplementary, because, I mean, you've got people in schools, and I would hope you can assure me that they are working on this. But absolutely, I get the impression, speaking to younger people if I visit a school, that, you know, a lot of the girls just have not thought about engineering, and partly that's peer pressure or families just feeling that they shouldn't go into these areas. So, I mean, if you can show us figures that we're making progress, that's encouraging, but, you know, I get a bit despondent at times.
So, again, I don't have those figures right to my fingertips at the moment, but that's will provide, and I'm fairly confident, if not very confident, that some a change has been made in the metrics that around the original targets that were set. That point you made about you know, the messaging that we put out, our careers advisors working in schools are absolutely, you know, on that message that, you know, construction is a career that's open for all, hairdressing is a career for all, any career is open to all. Our apprenticeship kind of marketing reflects that as well, on the diversity of different occupations. Our apprenticeship awards reflect that diversity as well. So I would sincerely think that that's an area from a Skills Development Scotland perspective that we recognise and take very seriously.
Okay. It's something that you have to start very early on, you know, so careers advisors are working with children in primary school to make sure that those opportunities are identified, that they don't feel there's any barriers to being able to engage in any sector. And I think that work that starts early is very important, because that's what lays the foundations to be able to break down the stereotypes of different types of jobs across gender. So very, very important to start young.
I absolutely agree with that. And the other area I wanted to touch on was kind of at the other end of people's lives, early retirement. I mean, I think it can be argued that by people retiring, especially highly skilled people retiring early, that is having a negative effect on the productivity of the country as a whole. I've got friends who are highly skilled who have already retired, same age as myself. Maybe I should be considering that as well. But, you know, is it a bad thing? Because on the other hand, that allows an opportunity for a younger person to come in and get become whatever, into a highly skilled job. And to bring in the National Performance Framework, we have other, you know, aims in society, like the environment, and maybe people, when they retire early, can then voluntarily get involved in some of these things. So how do we get that balance right?
I'll hopefully not contradict her when I come in.
I think it's certainly the case that, you know, we have a very tight labour market at the moment, and on that basis we really need to be making sure that we have the skills of everybody still engaged. So older workers are going to be important in terms of their contribution, the contribution that they're making to the economy. I think the evidence is a little bit mixed. I don't think there's no clear evidence that older workers affect productivity when measured at the level of the firm or at the level of the team. But some economy-wide studies have suggested that an ageing workforce might reduce productivity slightly due to the smaller numbers of workers in their 40s, which is sort of their productivity prime. So maybe that's one for my own employer as I turn 50 on Friday. So that'll be me beyond my productivity prime. It's likely to differ by job type, I think, you know, the contribution of older workers to productivity, with those involved in sort of more hard physical labour a little bit more challenging than perhaps some of the more neutral occupations. But we know that because of those demographic challenges, there's absolute value in engaging older workers and keeping them and retaining them in the labour market. But what that's going to take is a whole variety of different supports, whether it's around eliminating age bias, you know, in recruitment practices, whether it's making sure that work remains attractive to older workers through a good working environment, through a healthy working life, through flexible options, and really to focus back in on skills, developing and maintaining skills throughout careers, you know, so making sure that older people have access to the training that they need to be productive within the workforce.
Just come back in. This is drawn from the SFC's economic and fiscal forecasts, but we know that the biggest increase in economic activity of the age group has been amongst the over 55s, and that's been since about 2016 to 2020. Interestingly, two things I'd offer. So there was a lot of talk, and indeed I may have mentioned myself in a previous committee appearance around the great retirement that emerged as a result of COVID. Some of the early data that we've got suggests that that's more a UK phenomenon than a Scottish phenomenon, and that the kind of the leakage out of the workforce hasn't been as great as Scotland, but we expect that to become clearer in future months. I think the other thing that I would kind of highlight, that well, for the 55s to 65s, we've seen a big increase in economic activity. We haven't seen the same increase for over 65s, you know. So, and that's in spite of the increasing of the pensionable age to 66, and then kind of 67. I think it remains to be seen whether in that, you know, age group who've moved from being able to retire at 65 to retire at 67, what impact that will have on economic activity. I think at best the picture is mixed at the moment.
Okay, thanks, Convener. I think I'll carry on working a bit longer.
No, thank you. Michelle, to follow by Daniel.
Well, I'm actually going to pick up on two areas that John already referenced. I'm not entirely sure if that's a good thing, Convener. The first one was around the role of women, which is a personal interest of mine. I was reading through the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, or CSAP, and like many other worthy documents, I find mention of women and green jobs, pay gap, representation and so on. But in common with most agencies, women are added into the main strategic document rather than being worthy of a specific strategy document in of themselves. And for me, it's in particular interest as we start to look at the kind of transition around skills that we can be in at the beginning. So my question to you is, will you have a specific bespoke strategy for women in your emerging strategy? And do you plan one as your climate emergency skills action plan evolves? The last question I would say, statement I'd make before you answer that question is that, in my opinion, without that, without someone being both accountable and responsible, it will only ever continue to be a bolt-on to the main thrust. So,
who wants to go first? I'll lead on. So, by happy accident, you couldn't have got a better panel for a question on the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, because Andrea and I co-authored the document in the heady days of December 2020. I wouldn't necessarily agree with the sense that we ever saw women as an add-on in part of that document. Where I would agree is that what we don't have, you're right in that document, is a standalone kind of section or a standalone chapter which says here are the particular challenges that women face in terms of the transition to net zero. So I take that on board. You referenced the ongoing development of the plan. So the plan is steered, the implementation of the plan is overseen by an implementation steering group that includes, yes, public agencies and the enterprise agencies, but it also includes representatives from Equate. So we have Leslie Laird, who's the director in Scotland from Equate, on the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan Implementation Steering Group. And the notion, that challenge that you've made, actually, in relation to how we reflect that in the future development of the plan is one that I'm very happy to take on with Leslie, out with the committee, and see how we best respond to that, and indeed to follow up with you fairly quickly off the back of today.
And before Andrea, before Andrea comes in, it's probably worthwhile you noting that I've asked the same question of the enterprise agencies, and they don't have one either. So you will be joined in a similar view, because flowing from that, only if you have that are you going to then have the specific measures that outline success or lack of, and an absolute outcome focus. So I'd also appreciate your thoughts about that. How are you, from the start, particularly when we use the term just transition, are we going to wield these different areas? So I definitely, and I suspect it's something that we might want to come pick up again, given your comments, Andrea, about economic contribution. But anyway, I'll let you come in, because I know that's quite a broad area.
Certainly, it's a very important point that you raise, not least because a lot of the opportunities around net zero, at least on the face of them, are set out in the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, or perhaps in areas that have historically had more male engagement, as it's around construction, it's around engineering, it's around transport. So on that basis, as Chris has mentioned, something that we certainly need to focus in on. I suppose what I could do is compare some of the work in the Skills Action Plan for Rural Scotland, where we've actually undertaken a number of focused activities around supporting women, women into agriculture, specific projects, and that are there to be able to make sure women understand the opportunities that are available to them and have the support. We've also undertaken some business development work around child minding, and specifically for rural businesses. So the parallel, I suppose, is when we're looking at a focused sector, there are opportunities for being able to develop projects and programmes that specifically support women. And so, as Chris mentioned, that's something we'd be more than happy to look at with you.
And what you outlined there, because every strategy will always have both sides, a push and a pull. And so it's reflecting both sides of that, how you incentivise, how you measure other, your stakeholder partners, that they are actually producing rather than necessarily just encouraging them. And I'm not saying you wouldn't just encourage them. Another area which actually picks up from what John was saying before, I very much enjoyed reading your submission, and it was very comprehensive. And I was pleased to note that you made reference to some of the factors that influence productivity. And it's something that I've talked to myself about often. You know, macroeconomics, for example, are absolutely fundamental. Exports, R&D. And I was reminded of the example of EMEC in the Orkney Islands. It's lost its funding now, even though it's an absolute excellent example of a project to do with another area. The reason I'm pointing that out is to encourage you to do that in the future, because it's my perception, having come here, that I don't necessarily believe that there's the same understanding across the board of the factors that influence productivity. So it's simply a comment that that I thought that I was really pleased to see that. My next wee point was, I wondered where your thinking was today in competence versus excellence. You'll be aware of the Cumberford Little report that came out a couple of years ago, and I suspect that, I mean, I didn't hear all that much about it after it was launched, but in fairness, it was during the midst of the pandemic. But in that, they're absolutely clear about a move from mere competence to excellence, and excellence being that differentiator that will drive us forward. So I wanted to get a steer on where your thinking is around that theme, and how that again will feed into your strategy.
Okay, it's a great question. I think that distinction you make between competence and excellence is really important, not just from a skills perspective, but from a driving of productivity perspective. Again, we made reference to the apprenticeship programmes, and this is where I'll kind of focus my remarks. For a long time, for too long, you know, apprenticeships have been wrongly perceived as, you know, necessarily an add-on. One of the things that we have placed great effort in doing is ensuring that we work with employers to make sure that apprenticeship standards are up to date and fit for purpose for the workplace of tomorrow. Not the workplace of 20 years ago, and I think that's an important part of, you know, creating the conditions for competence to move to excellence. I think the second part is around some of the innovations that I've already referenced today, and that extension of the apprenticeship family into the graduate space, again, is a really kind of important part of that move from competence to excellence, so that, you know, broadening the depth of the qualification, have employer shape, that's a really important part. If you look at the experience in Germany, so our graduate apprenticeships go up to, I think, SEQF level 11, but in Germany the approach to apprenticeships allows the opportunity to have a Meister qualification, which takes you beyond the qualification of an undergraduate degree. I think there are challenges around embedding that nature of that qualification within, you know, dropping it into the Scottish system immediately, but I think that's an ambition that I know we have internally at SDS about how do you create the conditions where a graduate apprenticeship isn't the end point. Actually, you continue to build, you know, beyond competence and excellence in workplace settings through apprenticeship qualifications. And I think the other advantage of delivering qualifications in a workplace setting is the cascade of that skills and experience through the workforce. So I agree, it's something that potentially a big contribution it could make to productivity in the long run.
Do you want to add anything, Andrea?
Nothing to add.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you, Daniel. To be followed by Liz.
Thank you very much. I think just make one remark about the working, you know, the hybrid working, working from home comment, which is that it's really important to look at that holistically. Speaking as a former retailer, I know that people working from home don't spend as much during their working day. And you know, I don't think it's just about how many widgets you produce. That's not my main thrust. In fact, I just wanted to ask really two questions, essentially following up from Ross Greer, because both the points around labour market inactivity and then kind of the impacts on low pay. And on that first point, and just following up on the answers you already provided, I just wondered what work is being done to unpack that issue a little bit more? Because as Ross was saying, it's not new. I mean, we've actually been sending more people on to, you know, tertiary education for about 30, 40 years. And so therefore, we should be seeing kind of the outcome being at higher wages but were not. And what's more, if you unpack that a little bit more, it's about 40% are going on to higher education. But that's including colleges. And actually, if you look at just full-time university places, I believe that we actually have a slightly lower proportion than England, the England having overtaken us. So what's going on? You'd expect from that if there were a higher number of people doing higher education but within the college sector, that would be more vocationally focused, and that would translate into higher employment rates, higher wage rates. So is there work going on to unpack that, looking at you know, whether there's a mismatch between skills and requirements, whether those essentially transitions are working correctly? I think we need to sort of delve into those headline figures and actually understand what's happening at a sectoral level. Is that underway?
So again, there's a lot in that question. Yeah. So I may just take it in parts. I'll very briefly return to the comment on hybrid working. And of course, you're absolutely right. I should have also said that what's clear is that hybrid working isn't an option for many industries and for many workers. But you simply need to have a walk around Glasgow, Edinburgh City Centre at the moment to see that the impact of hybrid working has had quite a challenging effect in terms of city centre. So I absolutely recognise that point. In terms of the issue around wage rates, and also I'll pick up on wage rates a little bit and also pick up a little bit in terms of my comments on colleges and university and the journeys. I think an issue which we have wrestled with for a long time in Scotland, but we need to be kind of quite open and honest about, is that we still have too many people who are in jobs which are paying low wages.
Yes.
And that's a long-term challenge that I think everyone could put their shoulder behind and say it's something we need to do something kind of about. The question becomes, what can you do about it? And I thought there were really interesting comments in some of the previous committee appearances that our goal has to be to create a better range of high-quality jobs in Scotland. And that's important because it helps grow Scotland's tax base, which is a significant part of this committee's focus. I think we've got lots underway, and we need to think about that at different levels. One, and I think the Scottish Government has had a very strong focus and should be commended on it for the principles around kind of fair work. So it's about those jobs that are low paid. It's about being very clear with employers that the payment of living wage is important, and actually creating the conditions for good workplaces are important. At the other end of the economy, I think the focus on inward investment is really important. The focus on business growth is really important. So we need businesses to come into the country and recruit the highly educated, highly skilled workers we have in the country, yes. But we also need to grow our Indigenous business base. And at the risk of sounding like a bit of a broken record, I think that focus on upskilling and reskilling becomes really important. We need to create opportunities for people to progress in the workplace and learn new skills and develop. And I think all of those things in tandem, there is no silver bullet. There needs to be an approach that recognises the labour market operates differently for different people, and it needs a range of kind of policy responses. I'll finally turn to kind of colleges and universities, and I think the point I was making was just subtly different, if I may, to, I think that to the point that I heard, certainly. And yes, you would expect, and yes, colleges do provide vocational skills into lots of young people. The point I was making was those young people then often don't take those skills into the workplace. They take those skills with them and they go into university, and then it can sometimes be another 2 or 3 years before they're hitting the labour market. Some of the data we've got around graduate underemployment and underutilisation of skills generally, Scotland has a bit of a gap between the qualification levels that people have and the extent to which they're used in the workplace. Now, some of that's down to the quality of jobs. Some of it is the skills that we're putting into people may be becoming degraded by the time they get out into the workplace.
So I think the thing I would say is I agree with all of that, but I actually think the only way we'll make progress is actually if we do detailed research, both quantitative. I mean, I think we need more refined data looking at how these things vary by sector, but I think also qualitative, really looking at what those transitions look like, because I think I mean, I think you've described the problem. I think what we need to do is actually research so we can identify the solution. Can I just pick up on one thing you just said there, because I think it's absolutely spot on, which is that the essentially too many people in Scotland being stuck in low-wage jobs. Again, picking out what the Resolution Foundation have been coming out in recent weeks, I mean, what I find slightly horrifying is that while headline wage growth is showing at pace, that factoring in inflation and especially removing, you know, things, extraordinary wage payments such as bonuses, the poorest paid are seeing actually wages shrink in real terms and quite considerably. So at a time when so many relatively well-paid areas of work are screaming out for people, is there not a role for much more focused, direct interventions? And it's rather glib, but you look at truck drivers. How many people with a driver's licence, for want of a training course, could go and earn, £40,000 compared to a minimum wage job they may be on now? I mean, do we need to be actually a lot more direct, focused and surgical? Because while I absolutely agree with what you're saying about the modern apprenticeship, it is a big, you start it and you finish it. It takes several years. It's quite inflexible. Do we also need that sort of more surgical labour market intervention to get people into work where they're needed and critically where they can earn higher wages?
Yeah, I would argue yes, and I would argue actually some of those surgical interventions have been put in place in some places as a result of COVID. The risk of it is slightly technical. I'd distinguish between upskilling and reskilling. And upskilling is very much about raising people up in the jobs that they're in. Reskilling is about that transition from a job that you've described that may be playing into an area of opportunity. During the COVID pandemic, we worked with colleagues in Scottish Government and colleges and local authorities to develop a range of transition training fund opportunities, some of which were targeted to areas just as you described. Now, that was a lot of hard work and a lot of research went into identifying where those opportunities were, lining up training provision, getting people to make that transition from areas where there weren't jobs to where there aren't. One of the things I think I've been seeing today is that in terms of Scotland's skills mix, in terms of that £2.2 billion that we invest in skills and education, I think given the way the economy and the labour market is going to change, we know it's a given, we are going to have to focus more of that resource onto those priorities if we're going to meet labour market need and we're going to drive productivity.
Yeah, I'd agree with that, and I think we need to see those sorts of things brought forward. But finally, I just say I wonder whether or not our approach to skills is too detached from our approach to enterprise support. If you look at productivity growth, essentially, 90% plus of businesses are small businesses, and they have seen virtually no productivity growth, in fact, zero productivity growth over the last decade or more. And fundamentally, these are small businesses. You're talking about a handful of people working in them. And actually, you can't, in a sense, can't divorce the employee from the business. They are one and the same. And actually, having an approach which looks at business investment and support separately from skills makes no sense. And indeed, it forces us to try and kind of shoehorn apprenticeship approaches into businesses that really can't support them or sustain them. And I know that there's been lots of talk about apprenticeship sharing, but again, speaking as somebody that's run a small business, I don't want to share my employees with my competitors. I just don't. That's a non-starter. So, do we actually need to think a bit more about small businesses holistically and not separating out kind of investment skills, actually supporting kind of business skills holistically with the employee and the business as one and the same for small businesses to get productivity going in that sector?
So it's a great series of observations, some of which I think I don't necessarily agree are actually the situation. So I'll pick up on a couple of points if I may. So firstly, starting with small businesses, I think there's a myth that no small businesses engage in apprenticeships, and that's not the case actually. In a lot of sectors, small businesses are their primary
user of apprenticeships. That's not the same as saying that apprenticeships work for every small business, and you've given a very kind of powerful example of why it doesn't work for some businesses, and that's not something we can necessarily kind of act on. I think in terms of the relationship between skills and business growth and enterprise, and particularly the enterprise agencies, our work in terms of understanding skills needs in SDS, and all the time I've been there, is we can't write a plan unless employers endorse and recognise that story as their own. It's not my view, it's the view of employers, and that's a principle that we've stuck to. I've got a colleague who used to work, at one point Skills Development Scotland was part of Scottish Enterprise, and I've got a colleague who jokes that he's done more work with Scottish Enterprise now that he's in Skills Development Scotland than he did when he was in the organisation, and I don't know how much truth that is. What I would say, and I'll point to the south of Scotland, during the pandemic, every Tuesday morning, I spent 2 hours on a call with colleagues at South of Scotland Enterprise, with the two councils, Dumfries and Galloway and Scottish Borders Council, where we shared insight and intelligence, what we heard was happening. We shared insight and intelligence in terms of where funding opportunities were emerging. We shared insight and intelligence in where we were seeing labour shortages or people potentially being made redundant. And we forgot about our organisational boundaries and just got on and tried to do the right thing. And there's so much more of that kind of work goes on, certainly in the part of SDS that I work in, than I think we've done before. So we do work really hard to work closely with our enterprise agency partners and to get business engagement around the delivery of our services.
Thank you. That's very helpful.
Thank you. List to be followed by Douglas.
Two very quick questions, if I may. Firstly, when it comes to what you were describing earlier on this morning, the outcome agreements between the university and or college and the Scottish Funding Council, does that outcome agreement feature graduate apprenticeships?
I genuinely would be taking a guess at that question, answering that question. The outcome agreements are negotiated between colleagues at the Scottish Funding Council and individual universities. I could find out for you or ask a colleague.
I would be grateful if you could, because sure. I think it would be very important that they do feature. And also, in relation to your own job, I think it would be helpful if we could have a bit more of a joined-up approach to that, because like you, I think graduate apprenticeships are extremely beneficial. I just wonder if we're talking enough about them and looking at them. So that's one question. The second question is, when you are speaking with people in schools, how much comment are you getting about youngsters not necessarily having the breadth of a curriculum that you would like to see when it comes to going straight into the workplace and not necessarily doing college and university courses?
In terms of the first question, I'll come off the fence and say I believe the answer is yes, they are included, but I would like to just confirm that with colleagues in the Funding Council, and if they're watching at the moment, they're either throwing their hands up in horror or nodding their heads. In terms of the question around our engagement with schools, personally, my part of the business doesn't do a huge amount of direct engagement with schools. We do a lot of direct engagement with employers. That issue that you've raised there is not one that I hear regularly or recognise as one that's an issue I hear regularly from employers. What we are much more likely to hear about are questions around the efficacy of existing apprenticeship programmes in terms of providing young people or indeed older workers with the skills to operate in that workplace, and also about the fit and the appropriateness and the volume of both skills in the labour market as well as college and university provision, but that's not something I hear an awful lot about.
Okay, thank you. I just think there's a bit of a disconnect there. I think we need to do more than that. Thank you.
Thank you, Douglas.
Thank you, convener. Couple of questions. One was around the Green Jobs Workforce Academy. Is there any data yet on how effective that's been and how many people it's helped into new employment? Or is it still early days on that, I guess?
Yeah, I mean, it's again, I'll provide some written data by way of follow-up. There's always a danger with so many numbers that I quote numbers that are taken as gospel, but I'll do my level best. First thing I would say is that the academy is only 7-8 months old. And we developed an original product which we always envisaged would have later functionality, and that work is kind of ongoing. At the moment, I hesitate here, I'm certainly in the right ballpark, but I may get the number slightly wrong. I think we've had about 3,800 individuals who have used the site and who followed through. I don't understand the technicalities in this, but I'm assured by our digital team that the hit rate, which describes the kind of follow-on of individuals then going on to different parts of the site, is strong. What we don't have data on at the moment, and this was asked at a previous committee appearance, is the extent to which the Academy is then moving people on to, for example, a college in Aberdeen or in Glasgow or in Edinburgh as a result of the engagement with the site. That's something that we're working on in terms of building that functionality in. The other thing I would say is that the Green Jobs Workforce Academy isn't something that we've heavily marketed today, recognising that that functionality that they would like to see in the Workforce Academy, which includes access to the full range of courses, training provision that's available across Scotland, potentially includes access to funding support. That is not quite there yet. So we would expect to see those numbers going up considerably as the Workforce Academy moves into its kind of full scale of operation.
Present then, is it really more of a signposting site to show people where maybe like potentially green jobs are and also green training is, or maybe is that a bit too simplistic?
I think it's about more than that. So the ambitions for the Green Jobs Workforce Academy are absolutely to get the message out around the range of opportunities that there are here and now in relation to the transition to net zero, but also the opportunities that will come. It's targeted, very much at adults, but it's targeted at some of those groups that I think Mr. Johnson described in terms of people who might be looking to make a shift in terms of career. It's got an assessment tool on there that helps people who are currently in employment. And for example, the example I always give is someone who's working in heating and plumbing, who is, who can fit gas boilers. What skills do you need to develop to be able to fit, heat pumps or alternative technologies, and where would you find those kind of skills? There's also a part of it where what it is doing is it's aggregating some of that learning content that's already available and making it available to individuals free at the point of use. And in time, we're working on the development of a skills wallet that would see a kind of stratified entitlement. So, depending on the individual's circumstances and the extent to which they were available for other funding, that someone perhaps based in Inverclyde who was unemployed would get access to a greater training entitlement than someone like myself who's in Glasgow and fully employed. But there would be a stratified entitlement that would allow people to then access training as it develops. I think the important thing to say as well is that the Green Jobs Workforce Academy doesn't sit on its own. So we are focused on making clear to people in the workforce what is available just now, how to access it, where their skills needs to be. We're working concurrently with colleges, particularly through the Energy Skills Partnership, to build that capability in green skills across Scotland's college network. So there's a bit where, the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, almost if you did nothing else, would expand in terms of its availability of provision because the skill system will catch up.
I guess my next question, which ties into this, is around ScotWind and how involved you are with that and how to make sure that we have all the opportunities that we can get from that remaining in Scotland.
I mean, ScotWind's a great example, but it's not the only example. I mean, we're looking as well at some of the potential legislative drivers around decarbonisation of heating buildings. And rather than going into the specifics of our engagement with ScotWind, we know we're at the licensing stage again. The approach that we're taking is let's get close to the developers or the employers in respect to decarbonisation of heating building. Let's understand when that investment is likely to hit the ground. So is it 2022, 23, 24, 25? And let's understand where skills are currently available and where they're not. And we've got a very focused piece of work at the moment with colleagues in Glasgow looking around at the decarbonisation of heating buildings. And what that will land us on is a kind of gap analysis of, you know, how many people do we think we need? What sorts of skills are existing in the workforce? What is missing? And how can local colleges, regional colleges, then develop curriculum with employers that ensures that those needs are met? Where the Green Jobs Workforce Academy potentially comes into its own, that we don't want to just see change in Glasgow or change in Inverness or change in Aberdeen. That provision needs to, you know, either be licensed or delivered through the whole of Scotland's colleges or move on to the academy platform where, you know, that investment in new training is made available to all.
Scotland, has that engagement already started with potential employers?
It has, and again, that's not directly through my team. There's another colleague of mine who's leading on engagement with Scotland, but that approach, again, is about understanding what's the timing for the investment. You know, we know we've licensed for a significant uplift in terms of, you know, Scotland's offshore wind capability. It's about understanding, you know, how much of that is going to happen and when, and what are the specific requirements that are going to be driven. Again, I'll go back to a previous example. I did some work going back 15 years ago in terms of the decommissioning of oil and gas rigs in Shetland, and it was seen at the time, decommissioning of oil and gas rigs in Scotland, it was seen at the time as, you know, a significant opportunity for Scotland. The reality was some of that didn't transpire, but the work that we did was to say, what's involved in breaking up an oil rig? You know, where does the money flow? Where does that translate into jobs? And actually, are those jobs available in local labour markets? I mean, our role in SDS, I think, is to provide that kind of overarching national picture. It's also to provide some of the tools and the support to local partners to wrestle with what ScotWind means for Shetland and what ScotWind means for Aberdeen and what ScotWind means for Glasgow, because it will be different things in different places.
Information will then flow into the regional skills investment plans and also the sectoral skills assessment plans, I guess.
Absolutely. And, you know, the plans are one thing, and I think I should probably shut up and let Andrea say a few words, to be honest. But, you know, Andrea's team is absolutely about taking that insight that we gain from our engagement with employers and ensuring that it gets into the hands of local authorities, colleges, but more than that, that we're actually saying, well, what can we do about it? So there's a lot of work. I will shut up now, Andrea, sorry.
Absolutely. Just picking up on that, on the kind of regional skills investment plan or the regional skills planning approach, it absolutely is. It's about evidence. It's about working with regional partners to identify opportunities, some of those examples that Chris has given, and understanding what an opportunity is, and then looking at what the priorities should be. What is it we need to do to make sure that the labour force within a particular region are able to access those opportunities? And then can we agree some actions? You know, the regional skills investment plans are not just something to be left on a shelf. They actually have action plans associated with them where partners come together and deliver around these very specific issues that come up in a particular region. And that's the approach that the skills planning leads take, irrespective of where those opportunities are across Scotland.
And how do you keep them live then? Because I guess there would be documents that should be changing quite regularly.
Certainly in terms of the actions that come out of them, all of these are governed through either regional economic partnerships or specific subsector work, work streams that flow from those. And so partners always come round the table, and we'll be reviewing progress against actions, and they are live, in as much as if amendments need to be made, if changes to respond to new opportunities come on board, then partners do that as a collective by meeting together through work streams that are led by skills planning leads.
And is the last point on that, is there a review on them actions? You know, does that come back anywhere? Or?
Yeah, we just came in. So Andrea's described, she talked about governance, and in essence, we've got regional groups that are not, sometimes they're chaired by SDS, sometimes they're not, bring together all the partners, and we hold each other to account in terms of how we said what we're going to do. And typically what we've found in these regional skills investment plans is about 80 or 90% of the actions get delivered. Some of the things that don't get overtaken, but I think the point I was trying to make, and I go back to the example I gave around our engagement with Team South of Scotland, there are about six or seven things that we've progressed as priorities during the course of the pandemic that we've just rolled our sleeves up and got on with. What I've not then asked Andrea to do is to say, hold on, you need to rewrite your skills investment plan before we can move on those things. So there's the plans are really important in setting direction, but I think what's more important is at a ground level being pretty agile and responsive to what's been a really difficult set of circumstances over the last 2 years. And I think if we simply took a view that the Regional Skills Investment Plan was gospel, we'd quickly run into the sand. So we do try to put an emphasis on agility and working, and importantly for a national agency, listening to regional partners, you know, about where opportunities and where challenges are on the ground.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I feel somewhat frustrated because there's so much I think we could still ask questions about. For example, the rural and island productivity lag, to research and development, to core growth sectors. But I just want to finish by asking a couple of quick questions. First one is, people at school often just assume that whether they get an apprenticeship, whether they go to university, whatever, they will get a job working for someone. And I think, you know, I don't know that enough is being done to try and teach what you might call entrepreneurial skills. I mean, one of the things that I think is accepted across the Parliament is that there's a lower start-up rate for new businesses in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK and beyond. So I'm just wondering what Skills Development Scotland are doing to address that particular issue, and at what level it should be addressed. Schools, for example. She's always like that when she gets a vodka in her. And I'll just ask the second question as well at the same time. And it's just about people with disabilities. We haven't touched on that. When I was a councillor way back in the 90s, I remember there was a policy at the time that 3% of all employees should be people with disabilities if possible. The public sector, interestingly enough, lagged behind the private sector in regard to that. And there's been a number of initiatives over the years to try and increase the number of people with disabilities in the workforce in order to obviously improve productivity and their own quality of life, etc. So on those two issues, entrepreneurial skills and people with disabilities.
So, Andrew, I'll pick up on the first and perhaps you on the second, if that's okay. So in terms of entrepreneurialism, and I said way back at the start of the session, when I was asked the question about National Strategy for Economic Transformation, SDS has got a role in terms of working directly with colleagues in Young Persons Guarantee to ensure that that entrepreneurialism, easy to say, the entrepreneurialism is embedded within the work of both Young Persons Guarantee and also in our careers advisors. I think there's a kind of cultural thing for me around entrepreneurialism, and I often wonder how much it can be taught and how much it needs to be kind of experienced. And you may see me here in a shirt and tie as a dull civil servant, but my career has taken me through different routes. So I worked for a big American company when I graduated. I very quickly then started up a business at the age of 27 with one of the directors, before moving into a company and then starting up another business of my own before ending in the public sector. And I think there's something in Scotland about not being afraid, or people not being afraid to take the risk to try kind of something different. And from a very personal level, I think some of the skills, I was going to say that I learned, some of the skills that were forced upon me when you're running a business, I've certainly found useful in the career I'm in now. So I think, in short, I think entrepreneurialism is exceedingly important. From a personal level, I'm not convinced how much of it can be taught.
Okay, interesting. And Andrew?
Okay, so just coming to your question around individuals with disabilities, I think we know that around 51% of those who have core or work-limiting disabilities are in employment, so clearly an important issue relative to the wider population. But thinking about a couple of areas where we've undertaken some work to address that, we mentioned previously the Apprenticeship Equalities Action Plan works, which is very, very important in terms of those with disabilities and apprenticeships, where we've worked very closely with partners to focus investment to supporting diversity so that understanding, so employers know what sort of supports they need to put in place to be able to support apprentices who have disabilities to be able to work effectively. The second area, I suppose, of work is some stuff we've done around neurodiversity in digital technology. And I think this is a really good piece of work that's been undertaken with SDS, with Scotland IS, and with our enterprise and skills agency partners and industry, that's actually looked at the skills and strengths and barriers associated with individuals with neurodiverse conditions, so dyslexia and a range of other things, to demonstrate where their strengths lie and to support them into specific job opportunities that are available. So that's a very, very focused approach, some good research, and then some supports to be able to move some within the with some individuals with disabilities into employment, so a very focused.
I was really just wanting to see if a higher proportion of people with disabilities were moving into employment. That was really the kind of focus, you know, rather than what you were doing to move them in. But is it working? In other words, is the strategy actually working?
I think the only thing I'm aware of around that is that Apprenticeship Equalities Action Plan. I know the final progress report in 2021 did show an increase in apprenticeships from those who are disabled. Beyond that, I don't have detailed statistics. That's something else that we can come back to you on.
Okay. Right, well, thank you for that. We've overrun our time, and I realise that members have got itchy feet and have other things to do. I know myself and John and Michelle have another meeting which started a minute ago, for example. So we'll conclude not only the public part of our meeting, but we will look at our work programme next week if members are agreed, and we'll just finish the session there. But I want to thank both Andrea Glass and indeed Chris Brody for their comprehensive evidence that they've given today. There's still a few things I think we might want to touch on going forward, and we'll probably be in touch with you with regard to those issues.
To arrange a further session, either in private or in a different setting, if there are other issues that you wanted to explore and find that useful, so we'd be very happy to do that.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Call session today. Thank you.
Thank you.